Good evening. Welcome, everyone, to our September 9th, 2008 school board meeting. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And before we get started, I'd just like to welcome Andrew and Sarah. They are our school board representatives from the high school this year, so welcome and hope you enjoy your year. If there's anything we can do, please don't hesitate to ask.
Thank you.
And I need to tell you, they keep telling me they're very excited, so we got to be on our toes.
Okay. First is adjustments to the agenda. Alan?
Yes, I have a couple of additions which I've laid in front of you. There are a couple of co-curricular appointments. I think there are three sports appointments, and those are the major things that I will bring to you. I did also lay in front of you the report that came out yesterday from the State Department of Education on AYP, and some of that will be discussed briefly tonight by the principals as we talk about the beginning of the school year.
Okay, so the adjustments, you're adding that to 9E?
That's correct.
Okay. Okay, great. Approval of school board minutes from the August 26, 2008 meeting. Is there a motion?
I move that we accept the school board minutes from the August 26 meeting as presented.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca. Discussion, errors, omissions? All in favor? 6-0. Comments from student representatives. It may be a little early in the meeting, but you're on if you'd like to say something.
Sure, we'll speak a little bit. We had a very successful and productive first week of school. Sarah and I kind of began to collaborate ideas for the most direct and accessible communication between the students and the school board. Our goal this year really is to bring to the school board's attention the issues that are most important to students and to stimulate dialogue between the school board and the students. So on August, it was the 27th, we had our first SAC meeting. We had a very motivated and excited group of students from all grades. And, we kind of sat and brainstormed on ideas for an effective year and came up with a schedule.
Yeah, we have another SAC meeting tomorrow morning, and we hold them twice monthly. They change a little bit, but they're usually every other week. And we really want to encourage sort of an increased collaboration between the students of the SAC and any member of the community or the school board. I have a schedule here.
Oh, great.
That I can pass out, and I've starred certain dates, which are the meetings that we have, the last meetings of each month, and we really want to encourage any adult member of the community or especially any of the school board members to attend any of those starred dates, and we're really looking just for not necessarily help, but any insight or just simply sharing what you want, what members of the community want and what we want and how we can all work together to achieve that. So
great. Maybe we can get this on the website, our website, or maybe the high school website.
Yeah, we can work on
that. Helps to get that communication out to folks who might be interested. Does that make some sense?
SAC meeting. For our next meeting, I think we're working on rewriting our SAC
Constitution.
And coming up with probably our main pillars of action this year. And
we've also, especially, if any of you have seen the new cafeteria, we've been working a lot with the Wellness Committee, and we're really excited about all the new opportunities that's happening there. So those are things we're going to be working on.
Great. Wonderful. You guys have taken the ball and run with it. It's wonderful. Let's see, student reps from the middle school. I know they've been waiting for a long time to speak.
Good
The fifth and sixth grade open house is September 16th. It starts in the Ponco Gym, and students are invited. Instrumental night with Mr. White is September 17th. First laptop meeting for seventh grade parents and parents of new eighth grade students is September 18th. This meeting is not for eighth grade parents that attended the meeting last year. It is in the cafeteria at 7 p.m. The seventh grade class will be going out to Cow Island for the Ripple Effect program. This program is very similar to Chewonki, except the meals are prepared and some of the activities are different. They will be going to Cow Island October 1st and returning the 3rd.
Thank you.
Hi. NWEA testing started yesterday and will be going on over the next 2 weeks. NWEA testing is taken on a computer and students are tested on two areas, math and reading. The fifth grade picnic was September 3rd and reported back as a success. The seventh and eighth grade mandatory fall sports night had a huge turn up. Picture day was September 4th, and for those classes who did not get their pictures taken, will get theirs taken September 11th, I believe. And I was asked by Susan Dana to bring this up. The United Nations has proclaimed 2008 the International Year of Languages. The CEMS World Language Team has organized three activities related to this theme, a multicultural book club, a special 2008 World Language Week, and a Hear Our Stories Cafe and Lecture Series. The first event in the Hear Our Stories Lecture Series will be held at the Cape Elizabeth Community Services Center on September 25th. Immigrants from Latin America and Caribbean countries will share their personal stories and the struggles and excitement of their first journeys to Maine. The audience will hear about interesting customs and food and learn about some of the similarities and differences between the countries. There will be two other evening programs in the series on October 16th and November 20th, and we'll hear from natives of Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. The program is sponsored by the CEMS World Language Team, and it is funded by a grant from CEEF, the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation. Admission is free, and we'd like to invite you, the school board members, as a member and members of the public. If you have questions, you may contact the CEMS World Language Team. And she also asked me to hand these around.
Thank you.
And that's it.
Can you tell us what your names are so we can write
them? I'm Michaela Ford, and
I'm Jamie Dalcola.
Great, thank you. Any questions for them?
I have a question. What is Instrument Night?
Instrument Night is, I think it's where the fifth graders are introduced to the band program and learn about like the different instruments they can play.
And I think you're able to rent, mm-hmm. sign up to rent the instruments that night.
Uh-huh. Right. Thank you.
That next year.
That's coming up.
I thought I might want to know.
Is that it?
Thank you very much.
One more?
Question. Could you guys tell or let people know, you guys had an interesting meeting today about what fundraiser are you kicking off that we would love the community support for to support Chewonki and Cow Island and Ripple Effect?
Yeah, Sally Foster. Yeah, and we're doing Sally Foster program to raise money for Chewonki for the sixth graders, and they're starting a new program for the seventh graders, the Ripple Effect, instead of Cave.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Comments from the public on non-agenda items. Is there anyone from the public to speak on non-agenda items? Nope, seeing none, we'll move on. Communications, Alan, budget update.
Yes, I'd like to take a few minutes just to talk about the budget process since it is well in all of our minds as we've gone through it for several months. This evening I'll take the few minutes to talk about the public process that we went through, which did turn into a very long process for 2008-2009 budget. Although the school board and I recognized that there were strong feelings on both sides of the final budget, I want to acknowledge the fact that this beginning process of the public vote has been, when you listen carefully, a true learning experience for each of us. Just as a reminder, the whole budget process for our 08-09 budget began in September of 2007, so just a year ago. At that point in time, The entire administrative team sat with me to do initial planning. We talked about needs that have accumulated over the years and the effect that these needs were having on classroom instruction and performance. In October, the school board met and looked at what we were talking about, what they felt the needs were, and we began to look at both the specific needs of the schools, plus specific needs that board members brought up at that point in time, might range anywhere from textbooks in the classroom to review of the sports programs, etc. So that by November, the school board gave me the direction to go ahead and develop a budget that was based on the needs as identified by the school board members and the needs of the system. Now again, we're early, that's much earlier than we've normally done it, but we began that work intently at that point. During November and December, the administrators worked on their budget, putting the budget ideas together, remembering what we were told to do. Make it show what is absolutely needed to provide the appropriate programs for every young person in our district. During the week prior to December break, each administrator presented his or her budget to me and to Paulina Portria. In January, the initial amounts came in, and you saw for the first time a budget, which was much larger than it normally is. It was a 12.28% budget. Since the board had asked me to present the entire budget without cuts, that 12.28 budget was presented to the school board in February as my budget recommendation to them. Administrators spent an enormous amount of time preparing that budget, and the information they gave about the budget was very carefully worded and very carefully considered based on what our school system needs. Discussions about the budget demonstrated both positive feedback for the information and concerns about actual total costs. The discussion of the needs of students remained the underpinning of every discussion we had. Throughout that process, we were very cognizant of contractual agreements regarding salaries and fringe benefits. We were watching very carefully the rapidly rising cost of energy. And we were also working closely with Dominic as he restructured our instructional support, which is formerly our special education programs, to truly meet the needs of all students within the confines of Cape Elizabeth instead of outside placement. As we did this, we also carefully monitored the necessary work in developing a comprehensive curriculum, a program, strong assessment data, and the development of data to guide our instructional programs. Along with this, we revised regular education, because of regular education law, we also looked at the RTI model, which was at the beginning a very slow process as we began to look at it. We changed within the schools from the types of groups we had had before, the SAT, the PAT, and the TAT, into the SST. And if you want any more initials, I'll see if I can come up with them. But what it did was it provided us with a concentrated look on every single student who may be having problems either socially or academically in the process. It has been a very interesting process. Last year really was a testing year to see where we went and how it would work. But that all played a role in the consideration of budget. At the same time, we were reviewing other areas in the school department. We were looking at athletics. We looked at co-curricular programs. We looked at instructional programs, including foreign language, high school literacy, executive skills development, strengthening mathematics instruction based on assessment data, wellness initiatives, improved pre-high school science, and the list went on and on and on. At the same time, we're developing a teacher leader mode where teachers would bring their skills as teachers into the model that supported staff in curriculum development, assessment, and strong instruction. Because we are very clear that the best work comes out of teachers in the field who know and understand on a daily basis what goes on and what is excellent instruction. All of those pieces played an integral role in every step we took in the budget process. There were concerns addressed around the number of students dropping within the school system, and that was addressed many times over. What was not recognized by many is that strong teacher leadership taught lessons that helped curriculum development. And therefore, you began to see in the system several teacher leaders at middle school, at Pond Cove Middle School and the beginning in high school, particularly with the reading component we were looking for, and also looking at how we are going to teach organizational skills. In this process, the curriculum director's position was cut. It was a position that was placed in the school system several years ago, but I saw, as we went through the budget, I was not going to be able to maintain that position with any budget that dropped below the 12.28. So at one point, the decision was made that we would be cutting that position. However, we would not be cutting the programs. We would continue to work on curriculum, instruction, assessment, and RTI. Those would be the basic of what we did. And that data collection and use would become a key component in how we moved ahead. So eventually, the board came to a point of a 6.0 budget. The majority of the school board could support that. And so that is what they presented to the town council. The town council, after much discussion and debate, presented a 4.6% budget. If you remember correctly, because of the change in state law, that had to go to the voters. The first time that has been done in not only Cape Elizabeth, but in most communities except for SADs. That went to the voters, and as you know, that was voted down with a very clear message that people felt it was too small. It came back to me and to the board. We came back with a 5.3% budget, which was kind of a halfway between 6.0 and the 4.6. As you know, that went to the voters this time, and it did finally pass. But during the process of from 12.2% moving to where we are right now, we recognized the fact that we had to make some serious reductions. We recognized the fact that this is a beginning picture of what it may look like for the future. The list of reductions include a broad range of decisions. Some of those had occurred between each set of the budgets. But once we got to a 5.3 budget, we were very clear that we had to add money for energy costs because we had already seen that energy costs had gone through the roof. We did eliminate, finally and permanently, the curriculum director. We did eliminate a technology technician, and we did eliminate a psychologist. At the same time, we did add some partial positions that were badly needed, including a half-time school nurse and a half-time data person. But those were, based on our discussions amongst administrators and based on my discussion with the board, were important pieces for us to look at. So today we are working with a 5.3% budget. I need to tell you that as of the day of the vote, the budget was frozen. The only money that was flowing was to pay salaries and fringe benefits, which I think most people in the system appreciated. But we were not spending money in other areas except for emergency situations or bills that had been made because of where we were, including energy bills. At this point in time, we have that budget, but we are missing many things. Some of those things that I look at very clearly are, during the past year, we have looked seriously at depression among some of our students. We have looked at substance abuse. We have looked at the past history of suicide and where we are today. Many programs that have been in the system have, over a period of years, been lost. With the help of Katie Lisa, who had retired and agreed to come back on a part-time basis, we began to look at some of those programs. We recognize that there is almost no money for it, but we are trying to do everything we can, and we are working with the Wellness Committee, with emergency committees in each building, which Katie helped reformat, and we now have a new HOPE program, which we are trying to move ahead with very limited funds. Each of these is looking at those problems. There is a list, and it grows daily, of needs identified by staff, by students, by parents, by citizens, and yes, by the Department of Education. And we are doing our best to meet these needs within our budget constraints. Although a $19 million-plus budget is large, the demands on the money grow constantly. K-12 Cape Elizabeth should be extremely proud of the work that results in a small, comprehensive high school, and the work that continues to enhance our K-8 educational program. Every person in the community plays a vital role in our work. My sincere thanks go to the citizens of the town who listened, who came to meetings as we discussed these issues, who called or emailed or met with each of us separately, and helped to determine what the needs are. I'm very clear that we are moving ahead with our 5.3 budget, but I'm also very clear in the fact that we are now coming up to a stage where we'll have to start building a 2009-2010 budget. I will say to the administrators, they can breathe a sigh of relief. It is not starting tomorrow. We're going to wait longer before we begin and give you opportunities to do what you truly need to do in your schools and not spend all of your time looking at budget. But a reminder that I give to everyone, whether it be sitting here in this room or in the public, that our mission statement is to ensure that all of our students develop the knowledge, skills, behaviors, and attitudes to become successful individuals and citizens. As long as I am superintendent, that message will be constantly out front. It will be constantly in all of our discussions, because our bottom line is students and what we can do best for them. Well-run schools that provide the educational opportunities needed to prepare our young people for this ever-changing world are extremely important. Although the educational needs are expansive, the strength of the people within our system can truly make a difference. It is so important for all of us to work together, the public as a whole. What we do now will lead to a world of greater successes. And that is my quick overview of the budget process for 08-09. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. The annual report from School Volunteer Services. Were you going to say something? I didn't know if Rebecca was going to, or...
Do you want to speak to it? Because I know you're on that committee.
Well...
With me?
The committee of one. I had the pleasure of meeting with Gail, actually, last spring, to go over her report. And it's truly amazing, the amount of volunteer work that's provided by our citizens, by our parents, and by our students, and the amount of financial support and also just donations of goods and services. I'll just briefly summarize a couple of things. Gail has summarized this very nicely. She mentions that over 75 community members have supported the learning of students in our schools, and these are 75 student members that don't have children in our system. And there are some who have really given us quite a bit of their time over the years. So I'd just like to mention several of them. And I'm just going to go with those of 5 years or more. But are grateful, you know, we're grateful for everybody who has volunteered as recently as just a year. But Susan McIver of 13 years for reading and writing conferences in the middle school. Alan Lishness of 12 years with the Cape Elizabeth Middle School Debate Club. Betsy Moyer, 12 years in the Media Center support. Ann Waker, 8 years of computer support, and Ed Nadeau, 7 years of the Junior Achievement Economics Unit. So that's really a wonderful gift that they're giving our schools. In addition, we have received some amazing donations from the community, including a refrigerator for the science labs, washer and dryer for custodial and art program use, an electric stove for the teacher's room, and a microwave for students to use to make healthy snacks. Our school mentor program is incredibly healthy. 38 high school students donated 40 minutes from one study period each week to mentor students in Pond Cove School last year. I find that really a formidable number. Total number of volunteers is that last year was 1,000, which is a breathtaking number, really. And the value to the system, if you use just the minimum wage figure, it's about $180,000. But if you use the national points of light figure, it goes up to roughly $480,000. So it's truly a very important piece to how our schools achieve the successes that we do. I think that that's a very basic summary.
Thank you, Rebecca. Alan, before we move on, do you mind if we move 9A and B up to just below 7D? Because I know that Lisa and David are here.
Sure.
And they probably don't want to sit through all of that. Maybe they do want to sit through all of that, but if we move them up, they have a chance to leave if they wish. Is that all right?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Recognition. Let's Go program. Alan received a letter, and I'll just read it briefly. This is directed to Alan, and it's from the Let's Go Robbie Lipsman, Project Director, and Jessica Sirocco, Assistant Project Director. It says, Dear Mr. Hawkins, Let's Go would like to recognize Susan King for her participation in the 2007-08 Let's Go School Nutrition Directors Work Group. This innovative and dedicated group met throughout the school year to help provide insight, direction, and focus to the collaborative work between Let's Go and area schools. The accomplishment of the Let's Go School Nutrition Directors Group included planning a comprehensive marketing and communication strategy to help inform students, staff, and the communities about the many efforts the school nutrition programs are initiating to support healthy food options. In addition, the nutrition directors were able to share their successes and even open their facilities to one another for on-site observation. For the coming year, several across-community activities will be undertaken through this leadership. The achievement of Let's Go takes 5210 to school program during the 2007-08 school year, and plans for expansion in the 2008-09 school year is a reflection of the ever-increasing dedication and enthusiasm of our district school nutrition directors. This past year was a great success by all accounts, and we would like to sincerely thank Susan King for her gift of time, energy, and enthusiastic support. We look forward to working with Sue King again next year. So, just wanted to share that with everyone.
And with the help of some, she's now Sue Buckley.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
Her name has changed.
Her name has changed, right. Okay, superintendent's report. Alan, opening of schools.
There are two pieces here that we're going to work on, and I am going to ask the administrators to give us a brief report on these. And the first one is the opening of schools, and the second one will be the adequate yearly progress update, which you have seen and which has had major implications in the paper recently. So I would turn first to the principals, and probably Tom, if you could talk first about Pond Cove and your opening.
You and they were just about what we expected. The kindergarten AM and PM floated around during the summer, and we had to make some adjustments in transportation, but thanks to the kindness of some of the families, we've been able to accomplish a little more balance between the AM and the PM, with some families voluntarily switching from AM to PM. The new theme for Pond Cove, we're finally acknowledging that it's hard to keep a family sense, even although it can be prevalent in the community, it's difficult with over 600 students every year. So we're putting a lot more emphasis on community building at Pond Cove. Daily announcements from the principal, and the announcements involve telling pretty silly jokes and offering sports math challenges to kids. And it does have an effect throughout the school. And pretty soon kids will be down there making announcements and doing the flag salute. We've also followed up on a meeting in June that about half the staff attended to make a really dramatic effort to get kids together more outside of their classes. So once every 6 days, remember that six-day rotation? You were little. The pods, as we're calling them, it's multi-age groups of classes get together informally. So far, we've been introducing ourselves to each other and singing and kind of lightening the mood. We'll be talking about AYP in a minute. I think the time has come, and thanks to the staff, we're seizing the opportunity to just get a little more school spirit at Pond Cove. Okay?
Thank you.
Mr. Conlon.
I think Pond Cove is folded over. Good evening. As for in the adequate yearly progress category, one piece is that the school made all the appropriate gains in each category, math and reading with all subgroups this year in the 2008 scores. You're probably pretty aware of what's going on through the newspaper or the local TV stations about the MEA writing scores for the eighth grade. Those came back with about, I think it was something like 78% of students did not demonstrate proficient answers to the persuasive essay questions, so the scores were considered invalid, probably based on how the question was worded. The question was posted in the paper. It didn't sound like a surprising sort of question. We do common writing prompt persuasive essay with our students. I, for one, would like to see our scores, good, bad, or indifferent, and I hope that other schools forward the same request to the commissioner, and we'll see how that goes. So our AYP scores look great. We made all the necessary gains. We did not need any safe harbor ranges and so forth. As you know, last year, one of our subgroups is on a monitor status, and that group made good gains over the course of the year, so we're in good shape. And the enrollment piece, we have this year we have 570. This is the one in the packet as of September 5th. I think we're up a little bit more from that. I think we're about 576. And the class that came in the door to the fifth grade is a large class, for the largest class for our school right now, at about 155. And then we have quite a swing because the seventh grade is currently at 132. So they have there are seven sections of every fifth grade and sixth grade, for instance. In the eighth grade, there are seven sections as well, but in the seventh grade, there are six sections of each class, which makes things actually a little bit different than you might assume with some of the numbers. There are numerous classes in the seventh and eighth grades, for instance, that range 23, 24, up to 26 in some cases. So some of that is due to the when Paul Casey went halftime, we didn't opt to fill that. We worked from within the staff that we had. So those numbers get a little bit interesting, but definitely workable. I think for the start of the year, things were kind of topsy-turvy, a little bit different start for us, very quick. John Casey and I did a lot of work together this summer and felt like we were going to be able to hit the ground running, and then the ground hit us running. So you just never know. It's just, we had, for instance, in the sixth grade, here's an example of things you just don't predict. In the sixth grade, we had 11 students move into that grade, and in the seventh grade, we had one student move into that grade. So you're caught on, uh-oh, what are we going to do with some class lists here when things just like the kindergarten numbers, things just don't always work out the way you plan. And then we've had some staffing considerations where we're trying to plug in some holes right now for some leave situations. And so it's just been, what will I be doing tomorrow? John and I will both be picking up a class tomorrow. We've already been teaching some. And but overall, the first staff days were very productive. Students seemed to be in good spirits, ready to go. Bright-eyed. I think they do appreciate the new cafeteria plan where you can get the fresh sandwich and some of the other items. I don't think many are taking advantage of that at this time, but it looks good so far.
Thank you.
We opened up with 567 students. Glad to have them back. That's about 15 to 20 less than what we were last year, and that's essentially what we were foreseeing we would have for the numbers this year. Some of you were at the extracurricular contract meeting, an ever-popular session for parents and students, and it is something that I have some mixed feelings about in terms of starting the year off with substance abuse as the major topic. But we try, I think actually we had more positive feedback about this particular one than any other, especially the things that all of us learned, I think, from Dr. Publicker, who was a very well-received presenter. I know I certainly learned quite a bit from him, and I know the Parent Association is planning on having him back for a more extended session. The cafeteria has been significantly sort of beautified, changed. The menu has been improved. I think I've heard almost all positive feedback from students about that. The cafeteria staff is working through the checkout process or money collection process. The lines are a little bit long right now. Part of that is the fact that more and more and more students, which is good, are asking for the individually made sandwiches, which are quite good and a nice feature. So it's been a really, really nice thing. There is, by the way, there is a senior lounge that Sarah and Andrew might have taken advantage of in one corner of the cafeteria, which is significantly improved as well. And I've seen a lot of seniors kind of hanging out there. So when you're, those of you who are parents who are there tomorrow night, stop in, take a look at that, take a look at that thing behind the wall, that's where the seniors hang out. and that's kind of cool. We are working through the bus drop-off and student pickup thing, and Janet Hoskins has been working tirelessly to try to work through the situation. It appears to be getting better. I still do have some concerns, as I know Janet does as well, about safety of students getting behind the buses, and then our students haven't quite got the idea of if they just go every other one after the buses are through. I sort of grit my teeth the other day when I was watching them sort of go through, but there are some things that we have to learn in terms of developing kind of a routine for students getting out. We made AYP. Today, the state posted on the state website SAT grades or MEA grades, which are basically SAT grades augmented by some questions in science and math that are added to the SAT in order to comply with No Child Left Behind requirements. And this year, I was pleased to see, that we actually came out at the top of every single category in the state. We are number one in math. We almost always are number one in math. We are number one, the first public school in reading. We are the tied for the first public school in science, which was interesting, because this is actually the first time we have a benchmark since we went to the Physics First curriculum to try to see how our students are doing in science. So I was particularly intrigued by that as kind of a baseline that our students are at the top of the state. And we are number one in writing as well. Some of those categories, there are a couple of other schools that are tied with us, but we are number one in everything. I did ask Troy Henninger today, by the way, to come up with some more demographically comparable schools in other states in New England that we can begin to compare ourselves to, at least against SAT scores, which is the only common ground for comparison now. So I'm hoping we can identify 15 to 20 schools and begin more regularly to report compared to those schools as well. But that's always nice to see that we are up there. Some students have got some students' attention when we met with the seniors and the juniors and told them about the drug dog policy, which is it's a more generalized search policy, which is up for second reading tonight. I did get one email from one parent who wasn't happy about it. I haven't heard anything else about it. We did a lot of data work with teachers our first day of school, and at some point, if the board is so inclined, there's some fascinating data that we put together in a folder about the high school. It's some subjective data, it's some very concrete testing data and that sort of thing, and we let teachers run with that data to see what conclusions we could all kind of arrive at. It was a very, I thought, interesting and enlightening exercise. And then Alan asked me to just sort of give you some brief information. I'm assuming this is the right place to do it since I didn't see it in any place else, about classes which have large numbers at the high school. Okay, so what I've done with this, and I'm not going to go over this entire thing, I tried to make it fairly self-explanatory, is this is a list of all the classes that are in the high school right now that have over 23 students. And there are really no surprises here based on sort of the adjustments we needed to make in staffing last year as a result of the budget and the fact that we are increasingly in a sort of a zero-sum game situation in terms of budgetary decisions that we're forced to make. There are some patterns that will jump out at you fairly quickly, and the first one is pretty clearly that with one exception, every one of the classes listed here is an honors or an AP class. And the reason for that is that's a very deliberate decision that we make, that if we have to have some high classes, in terms of the amount of attention that individual students require and that sort of thing, and in terms of classroom management, it is better if we have to have some large classes to have them in honors and AP classes. That's not unusual. What I've done is I've tried to put down here sort of what the class size is that a teacher has that's over 23, and then as a counterpoint to that, sort of what the teacher's total student load is. And you can see that most of those numbers are well within school board policy. The numbers that are not within school board policy are the foreign language numbers. There are a number of teachers who have more than the school board guidelines. One of them is sitting here today, actually, Mr. Peary. What I've done is I've tried to explain on the back of this sort of the trade-off that was made. This increase in foreign language numbers was predicted as part of the budget in some documents I gave to people. It is a concern, but it is a number that I think will decline, and it is in part a reflection of some practical realities that we faced last year that our numbers were such that if we kept the same staff that we had in the foreign language department, our numbers would have actually fallen below school board guidelines. And rather than sort of cut to the point where we have part-time teachers or even smaller versions of part-time teachers in the foreign language department, because that is very difficult to find quality foreign language teachers or part-time teachers, we made a decision to sort of temporarily absorb an increase in class size, but stick with all teachers who are full-time teachers within the department. I've also explained here the trade-off that was made in science that has to do with the addition of lab periods to our science classes in physics and chemistry, which last year we did. And basically what happened is the teachers continued to teach five classes, but they had additional lab time, which really created some inequities and some other just unavailability issues of teachers and that kind of thing to spend some extra time with kids. So this year what we did is quite self-consciously working with the science department made a decision that in the physics and chemistry in particular, we would cut those teachers down to four classes, recognizing that that would mean the class sizes would increase. The student load, with the exception of one teacher who is listed here, who has 110 students, the student load within the science is still within school board guidelines on average. That one teacher is an exception to that. But that's sort of a result of that. And the other classes are fairly normal, where you know you have just in the process of creating, doing scheduling, you have imbalances in certain classes, but we still end up within regular school board guidelines. There's some more verbiage. I don't know if anybody has any questions about that. Yep.
A couple of questions. On SAT, that's congratulations to the students. I know you're a data person.
Yep.
I have a couple questions. We've heard during the budget process, and I know firsthand, that many of our students take an SAT review course.
Yep.
And I'm guessing if you compared us to some of the other demographically similar communities, lots of other kids take review courses there. I'm wondering, I know when you had done a presentation a year or two ago, we looked at Bangor.
Yes.
Who sort of beat the odds. Is there any idea approximately what percentage or what the relationship is in terms of, I'm guessing that's a reflection on us, but it's also a reflection on the review course.
Oh yeah, it's, yep.
So I think, I'm just curious to know how, if you have any idea.
How many students take those courses? We are actually gathering that data now. And
thank
one of the things we're doing is also comparing. Right now there are a couple of different options for review courses that are there. And we're gathering some data about that as well, in terms of which ones work, which ones don't work. But we also, I mean, I think from the, I was actually meeting with a couple of math teachers today who are working on this information, and what I was told, now there, we may not know all the students who take SAT courses, because some of them are private and that sort of thing, but of the couple who are offered through community services, I think the number we had was 28 students last year in those courses. But again, that wouldn't encompass, and I'm not sure there's any way we could gather information about the private tutoring that's happening. That would be harder. That would be really a matter of surveying students and families to find out. That we haven't done yet. We're working right now with the data that we know from the courses that are offered through community services.
Thank you.
Yep.
And on the class sizes, I know we haven't asked our administrators to start the budget, but I would ask this of Steve as well. Is it possible to kind of get a sense as we go out throughout the year? I appreciate that we're in the student load teacher guidelines, but that if the class sizes are larger, the students are going to have a different experience than they are, particularly in foreign language, which is concerning to me. We've worked very, very hard to build a foreign language program, particularly at the higher levels where it's conversational. I mean, that was sort of, that's the hallmark of our program. When you've got class sizes that large, and I understand that they'll shift, but a child that's in French 4 this year only has one opportunity to do French 4. It doesn't really matter to them that 3 years from now the class sizes are back to where they should be. So I'm just curious if we can sort of keep track this year for information, and since all of these were based on decisions that we made and that we were forced to make because of the budget, it would be helpful when we make go through the budget next year to make those decisions to see sort of how it all panned out in terms of, you know, what decisions we had to make. Because I'm guessing we'll be in similar situations, but it, we're doing a disservice to our students, particularly in those topics, to have class sizes this small. So just, it would be helpful to have that information to see what it's doing to the instructional program when we make these types of decisions, or we're forced to make these types of decisions during the budget process.
I know it would be a conversation that I'll be having with the foreign language department, and I do want to just make one clarification. We are within school board guidelines in all of our areas, with the exception of foreign language right now. We are actually over a little bit in foreign language, I'm pretty sure. I haven't actually run those numbers, but I ran them last spring, and it was pretty clear we were going to be slightly over for this year. And I don't know, David, if you want to speak to it at all at this point, or it's something we can talk about later in terms of the effect of the increase in class size. I don't want to take advantage of the fact that he's here for another purpose, but... That's fine. That's perfectly fine.
I'd like to piggyback on what Trish was saying, because I had written the same note, monitor closely. I'd like to see what type of impact there is, because I would be concerned if this trend starts. I know that we're within the student load, teacher load, except the class sizes being that big. If this becomes something we start doing with the other classes, I would probably want to reflect upon that as a board, whether or not we want to be heading in that direction, because to me that's contrary to really effective student learning. So.
I don't disagree. I'm not happy about the trade-offs, and I'd be glad to engage in the discussion and bring you any information that would help you with decision-making down the road.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yes.
So the numbers that I mentioned that were sometimes 23, 24, 25, so forth, I'll give you just some quick examples. Mine appear to be more in, not as much, the numbers are good in foreign language, and there's a particular reason for that. For instance, in Spanish, we've got 20, 21, I've got a class of 20, 20, 20, and one class of 17. I have another class that has 16 students in it. The numbers vary because in the middle school, in the seventh grade, if students decide the language that they've had from grades three through six, that they want to swap out of that language, they have the opportunity. That's the FLES program. They have a chance to go non-FLES at that point. And new students who come into the school also, for instance, in the eighth grade, not having had either language, go into a non-FLES. So my foreign language numbers, world language numbers, tend to be more reasonable. But then I can give you examples of In the math, it's 24, 20, and these are, I'm reading off 7th, 8th grade schedules right now, 24, 23, 24, 24, 23, 22, 23, 23. Social studies classes are up as well, 20s, 22s through 24s. Some of our advanced math classes are at 24 as well. And we'll be paying attention to that to see what we're always, we did quite an in-depth study this summer with preparing a school profile on NWEA and MEA data that at a future workshop we'd like to get the opportunity to give you a look at that, and then we're adding that information to our website so that it can be further analyzed by anyone in the community. I think that if you had an opportunity to check out our 8th grade scores, for instance, you'd see that those are either equal to or the highest of any of the comparable schools. We're all within a point of each other there. 5th, 6th, 7th grade vary somewhat. It's a little bit up and down, but that's what we see every year. 5th, 6th, 7th grades will bounce, and 8th grade seems to be where they kind of hit their stride. So.
Thank you. Dominic, would you like to speak about instructional strategies, please?
Well, we started off the year with a bang. We have lots of training to do in instructional support, so we brought in people early on to do training and the required day treatment. I'm not going to give you lots of acronyms, but basically we bill for main care and we have to do a lot of required trainings. We did a lot of those. We did a training in the Linda Mood Bell, which is a reading program for 4 days. So we brought a lot of people in, did a lot of training. We started off really well. The teams are teams in each of the buildings, because remember I have 70 or so staff, either contracted or tutoring, spread through all three of the buildings. So I have to really meet with them once a week, and we have developed new norms and team approach like we did last year, and that is off and running. We are about 180 students. We lost several students to South Portland, as Alan knows, but we have several kids in the referral process. So we were at 184 students last year, because I know some of you are curious about the numbers. So the population has decreased this year, the overall general population, but my population, again, our population is staying pretty steady. So I just want to make sure that message is getting across. So, and a lot of our students are in the programs that we've had to develop for behavior, as well as the life skill programs and in the resource rooms. So we're off to a really good start. It's been very busy, a lot of meetings, death by meetings, but we're working through it. So. Any questions?
I do have a question. You had offered up a tour to get a sense of what it is you do.
That's right.
And everyone else does that reporting to you, and I would love to take you up on that.
Great. I only can do it in twos. Alan approved it, and I was trying to wait till this, you know, actually when we get things moving. I know the resource rooms are going to be up and running this week, or even most of them are starting, but scheduling is a nightmare. Especially at the high school, trying to figure out, you know, the rotation up there. So absolutely, I'll be in contact, and if you guys know which pairs you want to go in and what time, we'll give you a tour of all three buildings. So, and I'll be your tour guide if you want. So, great.
Thank you, Doug. Janet, I would like if you could speak for just a couple of minutes about community services and the work you've been doing. There is a place on here for transportation, which I'll go to afterwards, but just how that has all worked as the first few days of school have come in as well.
Well, actually, I think that I could sum it all up in one word, and that would be, wow. I think whoever coined the phrase, everything I needed to know I learned in kindergarten, overstated that. In fact, I think that everything I needed to know I didn't learn in 20 years as being the assistant director, because it has been a whirlwind of activity. In my 9 weeks as the director of community services, I have learned more about cleaning toilets and floors, furniture deliveries and moving furniture, the bus stops and driving buses and routes and paper deliveries and dumpsters and recycling and interviewing and hiring personnel and than I ever thought I'd learn in a lifetime. So from my point of view, I am just so thankful that Community Services has incredibly talented and gifted staff that can run with the ball in my absence because I haven't been in the office much at all, that the Pool and Fitness Center once again has competent and extremely wonderful staff, that they can continue to run the facility without me being there with my thumb on top of them, because I have been visiting bus stops and riding on buses and checking out the floors and the hallways and the toilets and all of that. So overall, however, we have the brochure out, and I think we've got a nice brochure layout and design. Our programs, I think we have a great display of programs for the community to choose from, both adult and youth programs, and we are up and running and doing fine in the Community Services office. So, thank you.
Thank you. The other person who is going to report tonight is Jeff Thorek, but he had a meeting, or I don't know if he had a meeting or an athletic event. That may be it. So he will be here to do that piece to it as well. One thing I will go back to, though, quickly is for Tom, who was the first one on the agenda, who didn't get a chance to speak about AYP. So you might want to give them a few pieces of that because to show what all three schools were successful in that.
Yes, we were. And in case you don't know, AYP is Adequate Yearly Progress. It comes from NCLB. You all know what that is, right? No Child Left Behind. And you probably saw the press today with a local paper. One-third of Maine schools fail to improve. We have to improve as a school overall, and it's partly based on attendance. We have to have 90% daily attendance. PUNCO is about 97%, 98%. But the other principals alluded to the subgroups. So this headline's a little misleading. You can improve and still stay on the list. This is the year 2008. By 2014, every kid in the country has to have met the standards in the state, either met or exceeded it. And mathematically and humanly, that's not possible. So I just wanted to alert you that one of these days, either somebody comes to their senses or we'll be here saying we're all on AYP. Thanks.
Thank you, Tom. And those are the reports I have at this point until Jeff gets here.
Energy. Okay. So are we going to move on to transportation?
I've got the energy report.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Now, I guess I go back with a question that you asked a few minutes ago. I think the energy report may take a little while.
Okay.
As well as the transportation report.
Okay.
Do you want to get the two travelers up front first and do that, and then we'll come back to these.
All right, the board. Yeah, that'd be great.
Most
thank
definitely.
You. Who would like to be first? Let's see, we have Lisa first on our list, so.
Yep.
Good evening, my name is Lisa Melanson. I'm an English teacher, and I'm assigned to the Achievement Center at the high school. I'm here tonight requesting board approval for an educational tour that I'm leading to Dublin and London in April of 2009. The travel dates coincide with the April vacation. We would plan to leave on a Friday evening, April 17th, which is a professional day at the school, not a school day for students, and return Saturday, April 25th, 2009. I believe it's important to have school board support and sanctioning of this trip as a school activity, because it provides for the behavioral expectations of the students who come on the trip, but also it serves as recognition of the educational value of the trip itself. And I can attest to that after having led two previous trips with this tour company in 2006 to England, throughout the country of England. And I'll stop there for a moment. Students could go into churches, go into castles. They could see the effect of the Roman conquest or the Reformation on the architecture. It was just fascinating to see students connect their understanding of history to the places that we visited, and to see their enthusiasm, their curiosity, and their energy. This past spring, I went to Italy and Spain with another group of students. That was a group of 12 students and 4 adults. Again, it was a fantastic exposure to culture, history, and literature in Rome, Florence, and Barcelona. I was very pleased with the behavior of our students on those two trips. In both instances, we were linked up with other schools. On the first trip, I was with a high school in Massachusetts where I used to teach. Last year, it was with 2 random schools who had chosen the same itinerary. This time around, I'm linking up again with the school in Massachusetts where I used to work. And in addition, since 2 of my additional chaperones, one is Ginger Raspiller in the Achievement Center, and her husband, Ken Swanberg, chemistry teacher at Chevres, I plan to open it up to Chevres students as well. So that would be for 3 schools going on this trip. With 4 chaperones, I would expect to take 6 students per chaperone, so 24 spots between Cape Elizabeth and Chevres. Doesn't need to be apportioned just so, but on just 24 total students. I have 10 ready to go, ready to have their applications submitted, so 14 remaining spots. I've waited to put in the applications to EF pending your approval. What else? I guess the price of the trip, if anyone's interested, I can send details on that. I think you have the documents, the insurance documents and the price quote, but for the public's knowledge, it's $2,252. That price is locked in through September 30th for our students if they sign up before then. It includes round-trip airfare, hotel accommodations, a ferry between Ireland and Wales, and overnight accommodation on that, 2 meals a day, breakfast and dinner, entrance to sites such as Warwick Castle or Shakespeare's, Anne Hathaway's cottage, other different attractions, transportation within London and Dublin, and different sites that we see there. There is one optional trip possibility, and that's in Ireland, a full-day side trip to Powers Court and Glendalough in Wicklow. That cost would be between $60 and $70. In the past, you could choose in Italy and Spain, students chose to go to Pisa on a side trip. What I did was I split up chaperones so that those who wanted to go had a chaperone, those who stayed had a chaperone. The trip does include some free time, and students are allowed within the parameters of a few hours to go off in small groups to explore an area. And I guess that's it for my information. Does anyone have any questions? Okay.
It's not.
All right. Thank you.
Do you want to approve the
book? I think the issue is that where this does not take school time, it is not necessarily one you have to approve. But I think what she would like is approval from you that this is a trip that you would like to see Cape Elizabeth, et cetera, go on at this point in time.
Okay.
Rebecca, you look puzzled.
Are we approving this? Are we voting to approve this?
I guess that's what Alan's asked. Yes, they're asking.
So you want to?
Yes, please.
I move that we approve the proposed trip to Ireland, England, from Cape Elizabeth High School teacher Lisa Morrison.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Trish. Discussion? Questions? Comments? No. All in favor? 6-0. Thank you, Lisa. David. Now you can come up, David. We didn't put you on the spot this time. You're prepared, right?
I hope
That's
so.
What you get for sitting in the audience. Somebody can call on you at any moment.
Thank you very much for letting me come before you tonight. I am here to seek approval for an exchange trip between our high school and the Lycée Saint-Nazaire Lisa Aristide Grillon, which is in Saint-Nazaire, France. Last year, I came before you, and you graciously consented to give me approval to arrange this trip. It is an exchange. It's not a tour. It's an exchange where we spend a little over 2 weeks living with French families in France, and where they come back and visit us for 2 weeks at a later point in the year. I'm looking to travel in February. 16 days, obviously, is going to encompass some school time. So I am asking for up to 7 days of school time to participate in this trip. School time is very dear. I know I don't want to lose my students for 7 days, and I know my colleagues are very gracious in allowing us to participate in this, and I hope that you will support it. I think it has great educational benefit, not only to the students. It is an outstanding cultural experience, as Lisa alluded to with her trip to the British Isles, but also it is a huge linguistic and personal experience, growth experience for them. Linguistically, they are immersed in the language for 2 weeks, and they have an opportunity to improve their listening and speaking skills over that time in an immersion situation that we just can't replicate here in the United States. Personally, I refer to an exchange trip as linguistic chwanki. You're going and living with a family, and a family that speaks a language that's different from yours, no matter how long you've been studying it. And what French for in a classroom is very different from being in a home, and the syllabus is very different in a home. And the amount of language that you're immersed in is quite different. And it's taxing. It's wearing. You're trying to be on your best behavior. You're trying to understand other people, another culture that sometimes seems so close, but other times just seems so far. It's a great personal growth experience. Many people come back. Parents tell me, my child has changed incredibly in a two-week period. I couldn't believe they could have experienced such growth over a short amount of time. Likewise, when they're hosting in the United States, they need to be gracious and kind hosts, trying to make this person feel at home and welcome in our community, understand what their needs are, and address them as best they can. It's a give and take. It's a true give and take. And sometimes you give more and take less. And sometimes you take a whole lot and you didn't have to give a whole lot. And in the group, you see different people who are having different experiences, and that's part of it too, that someone's getting a little more tonight and I'm getting a little less. Or someone's experience might have been really different from mine, maybe it was a little bit better, but what I had was pretty good too. I'm very grateful that I was able to participate in it. So these are the types of lessons that are engendered by participating in this exchange. During those 2 weeks that we will be in France, we will have 1 week where we'll be visiting the school. We will 1 week in classes where I'll see the students every day. They'll report in to me. The school has been very kind in the past to give us a room where we could meet. They'll go with their counterparts to their classes, and they'll see what science looks like in a French classroom. They'll see what French looks like in a French classroom. They'll see what English as a foreign language looks like in France. It's a very different experience going to school in France than it is in the United States. And they get an appreciation for what they have here. They see some things that are very good there, but they have a different understanding of what their experience is here in the United States. The effects of this exchange go far beyond just the students who participate in it. Because when the students visit us, the French students are exposed the entire school. They visit other French classrooms. They go to the middle school. Last year, they were so popular in the middle school that the middle school wanted them back a second day. And that when the Costa Rican students came last year, that they arranged for the Spanish students to go down 2 days because they really had 2 days of work that they wanted to do with these exchange students. They come to the classrooms, they meet other Americans. There's a great ambassadorial aspect to this that takes place. Likewise, our counterparts participate in this because although their school is much larger, about 2,000 students, only a small percentage of those students participate in the program. The Americans are on campus, the Americans are in classrooms. Other French students get to be exposed to the Americans. So it's an exchange that that reaches out in many, many ways. So tonight I'm asking for your approval. Is it my understanding that you can approve it all tonight, or is it you give preliminary approval and then you take another vote a month from now?
They can do the full approval if they want to.
Okay, then that would be outstanding if we can do that. If you feel that you need, other times I've come to you, it was a two-stage process, so I just wanted to be aware of what I could bid on tonight. So if you're willing to give your approval so graciously, that would allow me to start the planning of this program. Should you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them at this time.
Sure. Yeah. I would like to make a motion that we approve the 2008-2009 exchange program with France as presented by David Perry.
Thank you, Karen. Is there a second?
A second.
I'll take Rebecca. I think I heard her first. Okay. Discussion? Questions?
It says the insurance is attached. I don't see it.
I sent one copy of the insurance over. I think there's one copy of it. It includes medical insurance, it includes repatriation insurance, it includes cancellation of flights. It's your typical insurance that covers those events. In the past, if someone needed some medical treatment, I would pay for it. The parents, the host families would pay for it. I would reimburse them, I would come back and I would submit a bill and get reimbursed. Likewise, we had a French student last year who needed to go to see a quick care physician. The host family covered that. I wrote them a check, reimbursed them. My counterpart paid me before he left for France, and then he submitted the bills and got reimbursed. It's sort of Rube Goldberg-like, but it all works.
Did you get that? There'll be a quiz on that in a minute. Other questions? All in favor? 6-0.
Thank you very much.
We're all set. Thank you. Thanks for letting us move you in spots. Okay. A bit backwards. Back to where we were.
Yes, it is.
Alan, energy conservation.
Mm-hmm. You have within your packets a memorandum for me. During the summer, as we went through the audit process and looked at the finances of last year, we recognized that an extremely high proportion of our money went to energy. And I want to say, to go along with that, that Ernie has worked very hard over the last few years on energy conservation. And I know that the Finance Committee has often reported what he has done. But unfortunately, the amount he has saved has still cost us because the prices go up. So the less we use, we still use the same amount of money. And so it has put us into a really difficult situation. As the end of the school year came in June, normally we fill tanks. We were unable to do that because we did not have enough money to do it. So therefore, we are having to do the filling of tanks now. So therefore, we are spending money from the 08-09 budget that we would have normally spent in the 07-08 budget in order to fill the tanks. With that in mind, we have spent a lot of time looking at the school system and what we need to do. Initially, Ernie and Pauline and I met and discussed some of the issues that we knew were concerns and some issues that I didn't realize were concerns in the buildings. Then we turned, the next step was we invited Janet in and we invited Jeff Thorak in. And we took a look at the position again. And we did it fairly quickly because we heard from Janet that she had the plan for the community center was coming out. We had to have some specific information in there. So we looked at some of the pieces to the puzzle. What I have given to you is a set of pink sheets, which are kind of the discussion that we had, because I know you often ask me for, well, what did you talk about? So I thought, okay, I'll give you what we talked about just so you'll have that piece. And then you have a white sheet of paper, which is some of the recommendations I'm giving to you. I'm looking at this specifically for that period of time when time changes, winter comes into play, and there are many demands on our buildings that increase the costs. All of the pieces on this memorandum are recommendations. My thinking was that I would bring it to you tonight, since this is the first official board meeting we've had, other than the quick board meeting in August, since June. So I want to go down through them with you. I would accept any questions that you might have, and I would be happy to bring this back in October for finalization, because I do think it has not been carried to the staff yet. These pieces are not out there, so I want to have everyone a chance to look at it and understand what the situation is. So therefore, I have several recommendations in here that we will take a look at. I won't read them word for word, but we'll just try to cover them quickly so that you will have an understanding of where we're going. The first one is probably the one that might cause the most stir, because what it does is it looks at classrooms. And where classrooms are supposed to be the center of our educational program, what has happened over a period is that many, not all, but many classrooms have suddenly also taken on the picture of having electrical appliances in them, including refrigerators, coffee pots, microwaves, and therefore that is an added cost. The understanding historically has always been that those things would be available in teachers' rooms, and therefore we would not have as many from room to room to room. We also do not have control over the type of appliance that is purchased, and therefore what energy it eats. So one of the recommendations I'm making to you is that we move forward to control what is in the classroom for electrical appliances. What I've also said here, that we ensure the appropriate appliances are readily available in the teacher, staff, faculty rooms. So we have to do both sides of it. If we take out, we have to be absolutely sure that our faculty rooms have what is needed for meals, for coffee, and those types of things. Of course, this also adds another picture. Is for me, who's been in education for 41 years, there were many years where students did not drink in the classroom, nor did teachers. That has changed, as you may recognize by this. And so I sometimes have to work at that and understand that, because it is a very different picture than what I was used to when I taught school. The second one is turn off lights in classrooms and other sections of the school when the area is not in use. Many times a light is flicked on at the beginning of the morning and it stays on all day long. And if you walk up and down the halls, there are many times when there is no one in that classroom. It is empty. But yet the lights continue to burn. And so we need to look at that and make sure we are paying attention to when we're using electricity, when we need to stop using it in order to do some conservation. The next one will be an interesting one also. That is setting temperatures in all classrooms. I took a big leap, and I will probably get beaten up over it, but I took a big leap of saying that I think we ought to look at approximately 65 degrees during the daytime, and levels at 50 degrees at night, except in those areas of the building which are in use. We, in order to do that, or any temperature you choose, we need to get to parents as quickly as possible to inform them about what this is going to look like. Particularly because if you watch schools, based on the developmental stages of the students, you will still see on a very cold day when I should have closed school and didn't, you will still see some students coming in shorts, sneakers, short sleeve shirts, etc. And also, what I have learned over 41 years is there are some students who leave with one form of clothing on at home, but somehow that clothing changes when they get to the schools. Now, you have to remember, I was a middle school principal, so that's where I learned some of these tricks. So we do need to look at the temperature in the rooms. I've also talked with some of you as board members who will tell me, I have been in buildings, and in some classrooms, I am sweating. It is so hot. And in some classrooms, it is very cold. We did look particularly at the high school because we had two classrooms which were particularly cold. One was Ted Jordan's room. During the summer, some reconstruction was done on that room, and also I believe it's the room just under it on the second floor, in order to try to manage that, because where I also had to look at something, not being a plumber, it took me a while to understand this, but I wanted to see where the piping went. And therefore, where does the heat start from and where does it end? and where does it jut off into other areas? And one of the things we did in my questioning of that is we discovered that in the reconstruction of the high school, there were some piping that was not appropriately placed, and so we're constantly getting hot water going up into the ceilings and going off into another direction. So there's been a lot of work done on that to improve that as well. Any issues with extreme cold have to be addressed with maintenance. Now again, I was a principal, I was a teacher. I know and I understand thermostats in classrooms. And I know in some places if you put a cold rag on it, you can make the temperature go up. There are other tricks to the trade. But
you just shared that publicly.
Don't worry, everybody knows it. Everybody knows it. So what I'm looking at is that we contact maintenance to have those things regulated, not to play games with them. Any issues about extreme cold? We also need to limit after-school access to the buildings. My original proposal was we would have 2 out of 5 days a week when the buildings were not open at night. However, again, working with the people who have programs in and out of the buildings, I discovered that wasn't quite as easy as I thought it would be. So we had several conversations around that. So what we began to realign was the possibility of closing floors to the buildings, having the cleaning done, and Janet has looked at how we might rearrange the cleaning accordingly. So sections are cleaned, shut up, locked, and then they move on to the next one instead of every light in the building on every floor being on. So we've looked at that possibility. We looked at basketball. We looked at practices. We began to look at the high school as perhaps we can concentrate most of our open time at the lower floor, which I always call wrong. It's the first floor. First floor. I always do that backside too, so I just need to be sure. So we've looked at some of those possibilities as well. We've looked at the middle school and some of the things we might also limit. We also looked at the fact that many teachers stay late at night to work in their classrooms. And as a result, the custodians have to wait, leave, and come back. And one of the pieces we looked at is we can no longer do that. If Janet has them out there cleaning in groups, then they must clean the area they get to, so that people who stay later need to understand that and move ahead accordingly to get these rooms cleaned at that point in time. We are still looking at one night a week where most of our buildings are closed. And so therefore, Janet is watching requests for use of rooms. Jeff is looking at requests of rooms for athletics. We also are going to try to control the number of meetings that are in buildings. I think all of you have been at meetings in some of the buildings where there are meetings going on everywhere. And so we have got to adjust that in order to conserve some electricity. We also are looking at computers, copiers, and printers. As you know, we have a lot of computers, copiers, and printers throughout the building. Many times, if you walk up and down the halls, you will see computers that have been left on all night long. You will see printers that have been left on all night long, and you'll see copiers doing the same. Now, I also had a learning experience with that. I decided I was going to be really smart the first day of school, and I was going to shut off the 2 copiers in our office. The next morning I came in, went into my computer, and nothing worked. And I didn't connect A and B together. What I found out was, when I did that, it turned off our airport, and so it had to be redone. So there are pieces to that puzzle we do have to look at and see what works and what doesn't work as we work through that. But we do need to get better control on computers, copiers, and printers. We actually have a program that will automatically shut off computers if we have to use it. We also, after we look at our printers and our copiers and make sure they aren't hooked up to something else that controls the system, we need to look at closing those down. Students in buildings have got to be supervised. We sometimes have the issue of students being in buildings. There was a parent or an adult there with them for a certain program. Somehow the adult disappears and the kids are still there. and therefore doors are left open. People come in who aren't supposed to be there. Doors are jimmied, so they stay open, and it's 20 below outside, so we know where that temperature goes. And so those are pieces we also need to do. And so one of the things that I look at is, I don't care whether the child is a 5-year-old or an 18-year-old, there are adults who should be overseeing what goes on and make sure that when people are supposed to leave the building, they leave, they close everything that's supposed to be closed and taken care of. The last one appeared in the newspaper a couple of weeks ago, and I've put it in here. I'm not sure I agree with it, but I have put it there because it is in the newspaper, and there'll be a lot of discussion about it. And that is the issue of moving to a 4-day school week, increasing the school day by 90 minutes a day, which the Department of Education is considering approving. They have never approved that issue before. And so that is something that is out there. I would say to you very clearly that if I were a superintendent in Aroostook County, I had bus trips that were 40 miles long, and I had all of those types of issues, I probably would be looking at a 4-day week. I am not necessarily looking at a 4-day week in Cape Elizabeth at this point in time. I think there are some things that we have to understand is academically, how appropriate is that to align our programs, and how well will teaching occur at that point. We have to consider care services that parents use, because I didn't have to use them when my kids were young, but I know how expensive daycare is. And so there also is an issue for daycare providers, and so we have to look at that. We have to look at athletic programs and schedules, because again, I look at athletics as a part of our educational program. And so we need to look at that and what it would cause in disruption, also non-academic times, etc. And of course, you'll always hear me say, is our curriculum aligned to meet all student needs, no matter how long our day is? So this, to me, number 10, was added when I saw the newspaper article. I think this is one we have to take a very close look at, and I have a feeling that sitting at this table up here, there are probably at least 10 different views of what should be done with that. But I present this to you tonight because I think we need to take a very serious look at energy. And I think all the people who work for us and in our school system need to understand that energy is a part of the cost of education. And the better we conserve energy, the more money we have to put into programs in the schools. Any money we spend on energy is not spent on direct programs within our schools. So that's a piece that we need to understand. So that basically is my overview of this. You may opt in the long run to do none of these. I would strongly suggest that we do need to look at the possibilities. I do strongly suggest that we consider what we are going to do, because we are watched as far as how we manage our school system and how we manage the money that comes into the school system. Thank you.
Are you taking questions, comments?
Yep, anytime.
I'll start.
Yep.
I have a couple of questions. Did you have a discussion about who's going to monitor compliance with whatever you put in place?
We did, and we don't know yet.
Okay.
Once we put the thing in place, then we are going to have to decide the compliance issues as well, because they do have to be compliant with these issues.
Now, I remember Gary talking a couple of years ago about that program that would shut the computers down. Is there any reason not to implement that?
I think Gary has been careful about implementing it, because there has been at least a sense of his imposing on teachers who are using their computers for X services. But once we get to an issue around conservation, I think that kind of changed that issue at that point in time.
So if a teacher was using one of their computers at home in the evening, if he had a program, would it shut it down as well?
I think that's a control issue, and that's one of the reasons I had the discussion with him.
That could be a problem.
Because that feeds into those computers.
When we talked about automatic light switches, I think I had given you a thing, and I know that he was looking at maybe doing some so that you don't have to worry about people turning off lights, because they will turn them off automatically when there's not movement in the room. Now, I've heard some criticism that if you've got a classroom full of kids and the teacher's sitting there, all of a sudden the lights go out. You know, people don't want to be waving their hands all day long to try to get them to come back on, but I don't know. Maybe they do, but I didn't know where that might stand.
Where we are right now, and I talked with Ernie about that the other day, he has put those in certain areas of buildings so that they can test it and see how it works. I think there are some at the high school, and I don't know the other buildings, but I know he has some out in buildings to try that. And the other piece to go along with that, you just reminded me as you were saying that. The other thing I do need to tell you is because of money that has come into us, we are also changing some of our security systems in buildings, which are going to also lock doors automatically at certain times. So one of the things you saw in here was there would only be certain doors that can be used for after-school programs, co-curricular, extracurricular, et cetera. And that program, I don't know the latest dates of that, but I know materials are coming in, and that is moving ahead.
Okay. Thermometer locks. In my past experience, I've worked in places where there were locks on the thermometers, and only some people had keys. And as cruel as that sounds, you know, it's easy to sort of jack it up a little, and it allows you to control how that's...
We had some discussions about that.
Right.
but again, I've turned it back to Ernie to come back to me and say, does that work? Doesn't it work? What do we need to know? What problems do we cause, and what good do we result from that?
And when I was reading in here, you were talking about doors closed, and is that because closed doors within inside the building helps to keep the
conserve heat?
Okay, yep. I wasn't sure, and so those are my questions.
Okay.
Sorry.
Are there thermostats in every classroom?
I believe so. I looked at Paul.
Are there thermostats in every classroom?
Thermostats are controlled by the energy management program that Ernie controls in his office. So you really have to go into the computer to set the temperature.
Okay.
Oh, so we don't use wet rags. All right.
Probably. No, we don't. If it gets below the temperature he set in that room, it will generate more heat.
But there's no, not your standard thermostat. Okay.
So they can't be adjusted from the rooms. Okay. That answers that question. Thank you.
You're going to try it out, actually.
A quick question. So what exactly do teachers do when it's extremely hot or extremely cold? There are a couple of rooms in the school that, I know you were talking about the structural soundness of the building, but they just go to Ernie and then...
I think the answer to your question is they should go to Ernie. Okay. I'm not sure they always do. I think oftentimes there may be concerns about it, but they haven't gone. And that has been also a part of the discussion I've had with Ernie. Just for the sake of all of you, we have normally historically had support staff meetings with representatives from each school once a month to take a look at them. This summer, in working with the administrators, we decided it was more important to have those individually by schools. So, for instance, with Jeff, we are doing yours weekly on Fridays, and that will be Ernie, Janet, Pauline, I will be there, and we will be looking at all of these issues on a weekly basis. We're doing the same thing at Pond Cove for 3 out of 4 days, weeks, and the fourth week is covered by the middle school, so that we are working our way into having a greater focus on what needs to be done, as opposed to having a focus on what might be done, but what do we actually need to do.
And Ellen, I just wanted to comment on the energy conservation. I think that would make for some very interesting discussion in the calendar committee when we are trying to balance what we might want to achieve as goals for, you know, improving academics, but keeping in mind energy conservation, that perhaps it would give us some flexibility and sound reasoning for why we might want to move in a different direction, whether or not, you know, it's approaching year-round calendar or other options. I know we were sort of writing some things down right now, but I think it would be worth having a discussion around that if this could be a motivating factor for some change.
I think it could. I would also mention to you, for some of you who aren't as old as I am, there was a period of time back in the early 70s where some of you remember where we had to close schools for several days in a row because of the temperature and because of the weather. And so that is not some, that is something that has been tried in the past. And it was tried in, I think it was 77, winter of 77. I didn't mean to look at you.
Yeah, that's all right. Okay, okay. I was a senior in high school and, that year.
So those things have been done. And but we, at that point in time, we weren't doing it to get a bottom line of what you did save. And so that's what we need to look at now.
I have another question. I know that there was some discussion back late spring with some staff members, and the discussion sort of was around what can staff members do to help conserve, whether it's energy or money savings ideas and so forth, and I wasn't sure where you had gone with that with your staff.
This issue was one that came up because of our energy needs, but it's also one that I kept very close eye on as we developed it, because through the teacher negotiation process, one of the things we have come up with is having a teacher group who meets with me and White on a regular basis to talk about those pieces to the puzzle. And so that's one of the ways that that will happen as we move along. And also you receive, so you know, last year I was doing monthly newsletters to staff. I've now started doing them every 2 weeks with different issues in there, including energy conservation and others.
Great, because, if we've got everybody on board knowing what the, where we're trying to go with this, it just can't do anything but help us out.
Well, and so, in fact, I think the reason why we're waiting until October to approve this is to provide both the staff and the town citizens an opportunity to communicate with the board about any ideas that they might have as to these recommendations that were made this evening, and also maybe some additional thoughts and ideas as how we can find some savings. And I look forward to hearing from the staff in particular, because a lot of this is going to impact their day and their environment. I'm going to withhold comments about it because I don't want to hear from people first. But I do have a question, or it's a question really. When in your background information there is mention of a lot of use of the schools by programs that fall, I believe, within community services or sort of travel teams, which are not school-related activities. When these community service programs are priced for citizens, and I don't know anything about travel teams and how those are funded or through what organization they're organized, but I'm assuming that there is an attempt to cover overhead, community services overhead in those costs. So if it's $65 for 6 weeks of an art class after school for students, part of that $65 somehow covers the cost of community services overhead, which is how community services basically is a net neutral, it has a net neutral impact on the budget. In that overhead, is there a calculation, Pauline, for the cost of energies and energy in our buildings? If not, are we not in effect subsidizing the cost of these programs by not including this amount? And in the past, perhaps that's been okay. But looking at what we've just gone through with our budget and looking forward, I can pretty much see that this is an environment that we're going to continue to feel a lot of pressure. And we might want to think about this, whether it makes sense. Is it even worth the effort? Maybe the amount of money that's spent on all of these evening and weekend non-school related activities really doesn't amount to a lot of money. And so it's not really worth our effort to calculate it. But I think it would be an interesting exercise to go through.
If I may, if you're referring to the community services programs, we're, I believe, considered part of the town and school, and so that's part of the one town concept of give and take. If you're talking about those that are not part of that program,
then we do charge rental fees, and that is gone into a use of facility account that is provided to the school department, the town, and that helps to offset some of that amount.
I totally agree, but because it's a one-town concept, when in you're pricing out those activities, you are including in that price some ability to cover the overhead of the community services, whether it's staff, employee benefits, et cetera. I mean, that is how you maintain your net neutral budget impact. So in that calculation, overhead typically it includes whatever sort of energy costs or physical maintenance costs. See what I'm saying? So it's not about taking money from community services. It's about saying in your calculation for a cost of a program in the overhead, does that include things of physical plant and maintenance? And I don't believe I'd go there, but most because energy is the big number, have we looked at that?
Are we talking about in the schools?
I think in anything where we're using facilities, whether it be the schools, the community center, et cetera, how are we covering those costs? And I think it's a very good question. And I think it's one that we will be looking at as we get ready to budget and how we do that. That's why I need to have this energy piece in place to see what are the savings there, too. But I think it's a good question, and it is one we need to keep on the table.
Madam Chair, in discussing some of the ways we could have saved energy, we missed some very high energy users. For example, food service. We know what it costs to run our refrigerators at home for a year. Imagine what it costs to run a walk-in or a freezer for a year. And those pieces of machinery can be made to run much more efficiently through better service and control of temperature and even how they're stocked in themselves. Water temperature for things like dishwashers. Think about what it costs in gas to keep a fry lighter at 425 degrees for a two-hour period. Can we change our cooking schedules and keep it at that temperature for an hour? Two or three burner stoves, two or three ovens, a boiler. The food service department, even in just hot water, is going to hurt you. And speaking of hot water and physical fitness in our gyms, showers, big issues is who's heating the pool in the fitness center. And I assume when Janet speaks later this evening about transportation, we're going to talk about fine-tuning that schedule. And one comment I wanted to make about transportation is for a while we've been using biodiesel in the town of Cape Elizabeth in all municipal vehicles, including school buses. If you speak to the mechanics at the Public Works Garage, who maintain all our vehicles, including school buses, the biodiesel is not working. You get less fuel mileage, gallons per mile. It's clogging fuel filters, it's clogging fuel lines, and it costs anywhere from 4 to 10 cents a gallon more. And the problem is slowly getting worse. And also the cost of diesel itself has finally started to drop a little bit. So it may be worthwhile to look at bus runs and the cost of biodiesel. It's lovely to be green, but if it's putting us in the hole, I'd rather think of education first.
And each of those pieces have been a part of our conversations. Like, for instance, we're looking at the high school right now because we have a lot of new equipment that is coming in, which is rated appropriately to save that money. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of old equipment that isn't.
I was just going to say, I think we've gotten rid of the fryolator.
Yeah, the fryolators are gone. There's a big cross on those that those aren't used anymore. So you're absolutely right, and we are taking a look at each of those pieces of the puzzle because we do have equipment in our kitchens, particularly at the middle school, Pond Cove, which are old. We do have some at the high school as well, but we are trying to use funds that we can get in order to make those changes. But we will be. Ernie keeps a very tight watch on how these things are used at every level.
But you can never stop looking at them. For example, even a vending machine costs you $20 a day. If you look at the way they're marketed, they have a lot of lights in them, and some of them are refrigerated.
Yeah, no, you're right.
You can save a lot of money just by unplugging them at night.
Or, as we just said on the other side, you throw them out.
I think they do.
They do unplug the vending machines, at least at the middle school, I know that. Yeah.
I do like his idea of looking at, and I'm sure Ernie, I know how on top of all these things he is, but to look at the food service department before, because those are some real, you know, expenditures of energy, I think would be worth the exercise if he hasn't already.
And that is not overlooked. That's, right. Those are things we're already doing. We're looking at every component of it that we possibly can. Any ideas, though, you have
you really
are
can't
important
stop
for us.
Like even the kiln and the pottery department.
Yep. All of those pieces.
How often do we turn it on? How long does it run?
Yep.
I'm not saying get rid of pottery, but start thinking with some common sense. It's an electric kiln, and I know it's a killer on the electric meter. It has to be.
We have some people down back laughing about this, but they'll figure it out. Thank you.
Do you want Jeff?
Yes. Jeff, welcome. I knew you were going to be late this evening. You had some things going on. Do you want to spend just a couple of minutes talking about the beginning of the year in athletics and the beginning of the year for you as well?
Thank you, everyone. I apologize for the attire. Just returning from an athletic event, so rushed over from Hannaford Field over to here, and normally I would be in a tie, so... Anyway, we are off and rolling. Things are up. We're off to a great start. The high school athletics started Monday, August 18th for preseason, and there was a two-week period there where our first week we were in practice, and the second week they were practicing and competing. So things went very well. Excellent numbers at the high school. Matter of fact, we have enough to field a freshman field hockey and freshman boys and girls soccer, so we're excited about that. So now it's just a matter of finding schedules and working out the wrinkles there, but very confident that that will happen. The middle school athletic season started last week on September 4th, and we are beginning to have competitions this week, and as we've kind of converted things over to the community, working with the community services, myself and Scott Labby. We've learned a lot on how the communication piece is gonna work. There's been a little bit of trial and error with how all these processes are taking form, and with the increase in the participation fee as well. So. That is a work in progress, but I think I'm confident that with the communication between Janet, myself, and Scott Labby, that will work out very well. And on top of some of the scheduling and athletic events, one of the things that we're doing, we're working on some smaller projects and some larger projects as well. One of them is the Sports Done Right initiative. And with the help of Karen and Janet, we've been meeting a little bit throughout starting in the summer. And met with some folks from Kennebunk who just finished the accreditation process and learned an awful lot there. And it looks like this initiative could possibly take form and really be completed by the end of this school year. That's a hope. That's one of our goals. Karen and I have been working real close with that. We have one piece we're working on is the parent surveys and trying to get a better database from parent surveys. So we're going to the open houses. Last week we had the 7th and 8th grade open house. This week, I believe tomorrow, we have tomorrow high school open house and then 6th grade open house as well. So we're going to try to get a little more parent survey, a little bit more parent feedback, improve our data there. Also improve some coaches' data, so we're going to redo our coaches' survey, try to hit all of our middle school coaches, all of our high school coaches. And from that point, the next step would be getting the leadership team together and communicating with all of our coaches, high school and middle school, getting together and talking a little bit about Sports Done Right initiative, kind of eliminating some of the myths and help explain and articulate some of the realities of Sports Done Right. And a lot of the stuff that we're doing right now currently with our athletics at the high school, middle school, and at the community service level, we're doing a lot of the Sports Done Right philosophy. And what we're trying to do now is put that together in a book, in a handbook, and have that information and have that initiative adopted by the community, it'll be a really good thing for our student athletes. So that's some of the stuff that we're doing. But I'm having it's been a very eventful first 2 weeks of school, or a week and a half of school, but having a fantastic time, enjoying every minute of it, and thrilled to be here. So I'd be more than happy to entertain any questions or...
Thank you, Jeff.
Good to have you, Jeff.
Thanks.
Okay, let's see. Transportation?
We also have a piece on here for transportation. Knowing that transportation plays a fairly major role in the day-to-day operation of our school system, I had asked Janet to speak to it briefly. I know she, as she said earlier, she has spent many, many, many hours dealing with transportation.
We are evaluating the transportation system several times a day, daily. We have been able to work through the challenges of the overcrowding in the high school and the middle school buses. Every year, the first few days, we have overcrowding on the middle school buses prior to the middle school athletics beginning. This year, it posed more of a problem where we had combined middle school and high school together. By the time on the first day that the buses arrived at the high school, there were three or four buses that didn't have room for some of our high school students. We did find transportation for them to get home on buses that day, and did some evaluation again and found a system that worked a little better day two. However, the timeline between the middle school and the high school was a bit of a challenge. Middle school gets out 5 minutes prior to the high school, and so we worked with the middle school administration at the rate of their dismissal and got it so that we have the buses coming down the hill about 3 minutes after the high school dismisses, and then the high school students can board the bus. We have a bit of a challenge in where do we board buses at the high school. Last year we boarded at the rear of the high school. Now when you have student drivers coming out at the time you're trying to go back, it doesn't work that way. So Jeff and Troy and Pat and I sat down prior to school beginning for probably about an hour and a half trying to work through every possible angle we could come up with, and the best scenario we could come up with at this time was to stop at the stop sign already that they had to stop at the front of the high school, open the door, and have the high school students be prepared to step on the bus at that time. It works. It's not as smooth as we'd hoped, but it works, with the exception of the high school drivers that want to exit the schoolyard quicker than we're able to have that happen. If we could just get the high school drivers to let all of our 7 buses out of the schoolyard and then leave, it would be much smoother. But they are anxious to leave. Our buses need to get out of the yard because they have to get all of the students off the bus, turn around, and get back to pick up the Pond Cove students. First day of school, I believe we're about 20 minutes, 25 minutes late getting to the Pond Cove students as a result of all of the various glitches. And I believe that the traffic light at the high school caused a bit of a backup at the first day. So we got through that initial first 2 days of school, and I think now our middle school and high school transition is much smoother. We do anticipate that in between sports seasons, some of our trip drivers will be on task for the overflow, so that parents don't need to be concerned about overcrowding of buses, just in case. And the Pond Cove runs, for the most part, have been fairly smooth. Where we're still at a challenging point is our kindergarten runs. We had several issues there. I don't know that you want me to go into every single one of them. I am still riding buses and evaluating runs. I think we've finally figured out the actual runs. Now we just have to get parents to know when we're going to arrive, because it's been a different time every single day, and that they can begin to trust the schedule. And we've got drivers now following a same route more than one day at a time, and so they can actually learn the routes. And I think we've finally got the timeline, get the staff, kindergarten staff, to get the kids out, get them on the buses, get us out of the schoolyard on time, therefore we can turn the kids around and get back into the schoolyard in time to start school at the right time. So I can say it's been an education, and lifelong learning is community services philosophy, and it starts with a director. So, and on the energy conservation, we do have a no idling policy or philosophy, so that whenever the bus is sitting still, the bus should be turned off, so we're not wasting energy but when it's sitting still. And that also will help with the fumes for children breathing, and you know, when they're sitting in the schoolyard and things of that nature. So we do have a couple of bus stops that have had been challenging. I've been out and viewed those. I will be getting back to the people to talk to them about that, spoken to the individuals at those bus stops, and other than that, if you have any questions or concerns, I'll be glad to address them the best I can.
I think Sarah?
Yeah. As a senior leaving from the senior parking lot, I personally was not driving myself today, but you know, it does take 20 minutes sometimes to get out, and I had nowhere to be, but I was witnessing a lot of angry kids, and I know there's really not much that you can do about it, but there was sort of a, I guess, rumor you could say going around that there are considerations of switching the senior parking lot location from where it is now to up front. I don't know if there was any validity to this or if that would even affect anything.
I'll let the high school administration do that.
Mr. Shea.
That's not a topic the transportation department wants to look
at. Right.
Mr. Shedd, you're it.
That was real, and it was based on conversations that I had with some class officers, and I think with the senior class the first day, about that as a possibility. The first few days, while Community Services was working through its issues, it actually worked well for us that they were coming here late, even though it caused problems at the other end, because most of our drivers were getting out. What I noticed today when I was out watching the traffic is actually the buses are now getting here earlier, so what I feared might happen that led me to think about, and I'm still thinking about based on what I saw today about swapping the faculty and the senior parking lots, is back on my thought process, because we had some close calls with students even after the buses. It wasn't really dangerous when the buses were there, because there was no place the students could go.
Right.
But it was students having waited for 10, 15 minutes afterwards, and it was
also,
there were some close calls.
Converging on one single.
Yeah, yes. Which is made more complicated by every now and then cars coming down because they want to get to the back of the school, so there were four cars coming down Jordan Way. I don't know
and then all of a sudden, juniors are trying to squeeze their way forward, and tensions get high. And
there were some times where we had people coming from four different directions, and it's a little crazy. I don't think we can do better for where the buses pick up students and drop off students, but we need to revisit, particularly in light of what I saw today, whether we need to change those parking lots.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
My thanks. I'm sitting here thinking, it was great when we were sitting in the calendar committee meeting coming up with these schedules. So I guess I would first say thank you to all the administrators who have responsibility of putting into place the calendar that the school board adopted. And also, this is really important feedback for us as we draft the calendar for next year. And I guess I would also throw out, it would be helpful if parents or teachers or staff, other people, as the year goes on this different schedule, if they have thoughts, concerns, feedback, that they should be sharing them with the school board members so that we have that take that into account for next year. I don't think, we talked about all sorts of iterations of the schedule, and I don't think once we talked about student bus traffic jams. So, yeah. Thank you. I hope it continues to work out, and we'll talk about it again next year, I guess, when we go through the process.
I'm sorry, has there been an increase in high school use of buses? Because I know, kind of just folklorically within the school board, we always just kind of understood that high school didn't really use the buses to a large extent.
You're correct, Rebecca, but now gas is $4 a gallon. Mm-hmm. It's now socially acceptable to be seen riding on a school bus. Mm-hmm.
Well, and so I would really be interested to know if we have any historical numbers.
I believe that the numbers have not increased. When the numbers of students riding the bus have not increased. We've now have 8 buses that are transporting high school students, versus when we had simply a high school run, there were 3.
Right.
That does pose a difference in how they leave the schoolyard and how we back up traffic and other things of that nature.
Linda?
And kind of going along with our last conversation on the energy conservation, we also have to look at the fact that mass transportation is much more economical, not only for the school, but for our environment as well. And hate to put the students on the spot, but parking on campus is a privilege, not a right. The school buses do have the right to be there. And sometimes it can be a good lesson in patience.
Did the school board, aka the calendar committee recommendation, did we mess you folks up by having the high school and the middle school so closely aligned with the start time? Because I know we had major discussions about that and thought we were doing the right thing in having that 5-minute gap, but it sounds like maybe that wasn't the right thing, and if you were to change it in some way, would you make a change and make it more time between the two schools? Or
the fact that we can do both runs at the same time, I think, is an energy cost savings,
right,
and does in many ways make sense. If I, in hindsight, could look back and do one thing, I would swap and have the high school and middle school time swapped. If we could get the high school out of campus at the time we're loading the middle schoolers, then we wouldn't have an issue with dismissal, I don't believe.
Are you only talking 5 minutes?
That 5 minutes made a difference in...
Can we do that now?
Why couldn't we do that now?
Everybody's afraid for
Mr.
further
Schitt.
Well, I mean, I know that it's complicated if it...
If we had enough lead time, like say half year or something, where you, in January, after the break in December, if a decision was made, say in October, okay, we're going to make that switch, and you had between October and January, would that make it easier? I mean, I understand you want to think about it. I'm not suggesting we do it, but just if you decide that that's a good idea.
I wasn't having in mind it's a good idea.
You wanted some lead time. I was trying to figure out what that was.
I appreciate it. I was
Days. Next Monday, all right?
I don't. Yeah, I think Steve might need a little more.
Yeah. Steve's mouth open.
Couple of days maybe to check out any, you know, what kinds of possible widgets this bring up that we haven't thought about yet, and then probably even well, to be honest with you guys, I would see Kate saying this is going to take an extra day and a half or something like that. So if we had a complete lead, even on that, just get the word out, get to make sure everybody understands. For the most part, kids are probably there anyway. There's probably not too many of them have gotten it down to the last second on that. So, good work.
No, look back to John Ho, right? Before I say anything.
Kindergarten will arrive on time, how's that?
That would be nice. I think what I would like to say is this. I think you're sitting here and understanding again, every decision we make has many pieces to the puzzle, and we have to look at all of those pieces. You're seeing pieces today that are difficult, and we have to take a look at them. We have to make decisions, because every decision you make has a counter decision out there by someone who has made a decision to do something else. And so I think this is an important part, and therefore I'd like to close my section of this by saying this, that the administrators have worked very hard this summer to relook at what they do and how they do it and how they manage their buildings. Jeff and Janet have come on board as new people. I cannot speak too highly of what they have done. They have really worked hard to get to know their programs, to get to know what's going on. When Janet made the comment earlier that things are going like crazy, she's absolutely right. But again, I think what you are seeing is just one small example of every decision we make has so many other pieces to the puzzle. And so it is, I think Jeff is good about saying only 2 days. I understand why Steve worries about it for a little more than that. But there are also, when they make these decisions, somebody is going to complain about it. Somebody is not going to be happy about it. Just like when we made the decision to change the school, the calendar, we had people who were happy and people who were unhappy. But I think that's an important thing for you to always recognize. I am so careful, and I try to be so careful, I don't always make it that way, to say to principals, let's talk about what needs to happen and how will you do it and what are all the pieces to the puzzle. And this is a good example of it. This is just one of many that we have to go through as far as taking a look at the big picture, because there's always people out there who want something different than what we do. And it's an important lesson for all of us.
Well, and there's always, you know, whenever you have a change, you always have to sort of sort out how that's going to look, and there's always a few snags in the ointment. Peter, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Kathy. And thank you, Janet, for having the patience to make all these changes on the fly for the first 2 weeks. It would have been chaos without you. Just 2 points that may be useful. The traffic light at the end of the high school driveway was mentioned. That is programmable. And more than being programmable, it can be manually controlled so that you can emphasize the traffic leaving the high school to empty out the high school parking lots as quickly as possible and hold up momentarily the traffic on Route 77. There's also another asset available as far as controlling traffic flow and safety of the students leaving the school in a rather rambunctious manner, which any teenager is going to do. It's really not their fault. I'm not going to tell you what I did with my car in high school. We'll just leave it there. But there is a unit in the Cape Elizabeth that is available for traffic control, and that's our fire police unit. You remember the uproar when we started hiring police officers to supervise our football games. These are not $200 an hour people like our police officers are. These are $20 an hour people. And they can control traffic. They have the state right. State law protects them. They can control traffic. If they make a visual report of somebody breaking a traffic law, an arrest can be made without being visually reported by anybody else. They could control your traffic, not saying year-round, but through this transition period of the first month, until you get things smoothed out the way you like, they are available when you could use them, and I urge you to contact the fire chief, which has control of this unit, or Charles Kennedy. Just another asset we're not using at this time. Thank you. Spreading out.
You are spreading out. Thank you, Peter. Anybody else? No? Okay, moving on to unfinished business. Frisch, consideration of policies for second reading.
Yes. First policy we're presenting for second reading is JFABB, which is Foreign Exchange Student Program. There were no comments or questions, I believe, when we had a first reading in June, so I would like to move that we approve the policy as presented.
Second.
Okay. And any discussion, questions? All in favor? Peter? Opposed?
No. Oh, I'm for it, excuse me. Okay. I was daydreaming.
That's okay.
It's 9:10.
Next policy, excuse me, is JID, Students of Legal Age. Again, there were no comments. This was changed for updating of legal language. So I would like to move that we approve this policy as presented.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All in favor? 6-0. Okay.
Next policy, JIH, questioning and searches of students and students' locker storage facilities. This is the one that Jeff alluded to earlier. I do not believe there were any comments in terms of changes to this policy as it's presented, so I'd like to move that we accept it as presented.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion, questions? Yes.
A couple of quick questions, not necessarily with the policy, but what you guys feel is the most effective way to get that information to the students, because this week we've been talking with students about how they feel like they've been briefed on it, but they don't really understand exactly what the parameters of this new I understand that it's a random search and that it's become necessary, or administrators feel it's become necessary, but I don't think students understand both the repercussions for different actions and what kind of, not necessarily rights they have, but what kind of place what kind of role they'll play in the searches. So I think we just kind of need to figure out a way to
the communication and the implementation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just going along with that, I mean, students, anyone at the age we're at right now is very eager to sort of share any shred of information they hear about anything. Since last spring, I've been hearing, you know, did you hear we're going to have drug dogs and searches all the time? You know, people have misinformation, number one. And I know that this isn't necessarily set in stone or certain right now. It's not like it hasn't been really presented to the students in any way, but I think that really once it is, things need to be really clear what's expected of us and what we're to expect, because I've been hearing a lot of really ridiculous things and going around, and I just think that people are confused. Kids are confused, and when kids are confused, they get kind of indignant, and I don't think anyone wants that.
Sure. Trish, do you want
to? Yeah, with a little help from Jeff, I hope. First, in terms of communication, that's a function that you guys are serving. When
yep.
we approve policies, what I've done periodically is I'll wait till a whole bunch of policies are approved, and then I'll send out a letter via Alan to the staff. But you guys are here every month, so you can go back to the next SAC meeting, for example, and let people know what policies have been approved. And how, with some help, you know, from interpretation, if you have specific questions. If you'll also know when we do a first reading, for example, you're more than welcome to come to the policy committee meetings, but if we do a first reading, that typically means it's going back to policy for further discussion. So you have a month, an intervening month, to get feedback from the students and then share that with us in the policy committee before it gets to a second reading. And policy formulation is one of the main responsibilities of a school board.
Right.
So the communication can go both ways, and the process allows for that. That's why we have a first and a second reading. In terms of administering and implementing the policy, the school board formulates the policy. The implementation falls to the school administration, which would be Mr. Shedd. But certainly, if it needs more explanation or I don't know, Jeff, if you want to step in here, I don't want to commit you to something. I'm more than happy to meet on behalf of the policy committee or let Mr. Shedd do that.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that for probably many of the policies, you'll be able to explain pretty easily and clearly what it means and how it might impact them. But I think on something like this, you would probably want to talk with Mr. Shedd and discuss what sort of clarifications or support the students will need in understanding the implications of the policy.
Great.
The policy that is fairly general in nature in terms of the authority to permit canine searches. So to be honest with you, I don't have, my first step after assuming this gets passed is to sit down with the police and frankly to sit down with some administrators in other schools who have done these, including Falmouth and some other places, to find out exactly what they have in place in terms of the way these things take place, and certainly to include students in those discussions. And I would be glad to take Sarah and Andrew or other interested students along as we educate ourselves about what this looks like. The purpose of it is a deterrent. The goal of it is to hopefully never find anything, but it really is in response to some increasing sense of concern among parents that I think really heightened last year significantly. That resulted in that prescription drug form that we had that many parents attended, and then the creation of this Hope Action Team, because there is a growing sense that it's getting worse out there. But there is a lot of information that I have to gather. There's a lot of information I have to share with students. We haven't made a decision. We're not deliberately not disclosing things to students. It's that we have a lot of work to do ourselves before we implement things. I know, for example, that Falmouth, when they first started these last year, my understanding is they started with the less complicated search, which is parking lot only, and not bringing them in the school and that sort of stuff. And frankly, that would be my inclination as well. I think it's got to be a step-by-step process and take our way through. But there's a lot of communication and education that has to happen, so they're perfectly good questions.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. I just wanted to add one to a these policies are fairly common. Many school districts have them. Yeah. And also, and this is a reminder for the rest of the public as well, not just for the students, but the agenda for the policy committee meeting is posted usually a week, a little late this time, usually a week before the meeting, so that anyone from the public as well as students, you'll have a heads up on what policies we're discussing. So if anyone has concerns, questions, comments, they can either attend the meeting, which are public, or they can share them if they can't be at the meeting, and those will be incorporated into our conversations.
Does that help?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Very much.
So it's in process. It's not quite there yet, but you can see there's a lot of steps that go along.
Definitely.
But it's good, as you said, it's good to be able to allay some, you know more now than you did, and you can allay some fears. If somebody comes to you and says, you know, I heard this, that, you would say, well, that's not what they're talking about. So.
Exactly.
Great.
Great, thank you.
Thanks for piping up. Okay. All in favor of JIH? 6-0. Okay.
There are also accompanying guidelines, JIH-R, which technically we don't have to approve, but those are administrative procedures that support the policy we just approved. JIHA, which is the current policy in our binder, we are suggesting or recommending that that's deleted, since all of the concepts in that policy are now in the new one in an expanded version. So I would like to recommend that we delete policy JIHA, student locker storage facilities, as presented here.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Discussion? All in favor? Opposed?
No, I'm in favor.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. It is moving too fast, Kit.
Sorry. I'm just trying to be fair. Okay.
The last policy is JJIBB, sportsmanship, which we had presented last time. This is one of several policies that MSMA has sent out in terms of sort of go along with the sports done right philosophy. There were no comments at the last meeting, our last first reading, so I'd like to recommend that we approve this policy as presented with a spelling correction on page 2, so that we put an E in the word behavior.
Takes all the fun out of it.
Second.
Behavior.
Thank you. Discussion. Did you find the word behavior, Rebecca?
That's okay.
You look like you're looking.
I don't hard for it, too.
Under D, penalties for inappropriate behavior on page 2 of 2.
That's okay. We'll be corrected. Any other discussions? No? All in favor? 6-0.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Trish. Continuing on with new business, we would go to 9C, consideration of overnight field trips for boys and girls varsity cross country.
Give me just one second here.
I'm rushing you to the
right
one, apparently. Staples. Here we go.
Sitting there somewhere. Okay. The first one is a girls' high school cross country. This is Marianne Doss, who's requesting September 12th and 13th for the Hartford Festival Cross Country Invitational. Parents are driving their own children, and it's in Hartford. The race director is covering the trip. Everything is free except entry, for which we will pay. The money is sponsored by the Northeast Dental, which I think is important to know. 7 parents plus the coach, and the students will go. The trip will only cost each parent gas, entry fee of $91. We'll be competing against 3 nationally ranked teams and top teams who are ranked in New England. And this one I have to have approval for because it's over the mileage for an overnight.
Overnight, and is it out of the state?
Yeah.
Out of the state.
I think we have 100 or 120 miles. I forget which one it is.
Okay.
Past that level.
Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the girls' high school cross country trip to the Hartford Festival Cross Country Invitational.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Linda got it that time. Okay. Discussion? Questions? All in favor? 6-0. Okay, Alan?
Okay, you have
Can I just note that I was wondering, that's why I was slow to raise my hand. We already approved that at the August meeting.
It was to the wrong place. I think just the location wasn't right, so they just wanted to...
Okay, update it.
So we got twice approval for the trip twice.
Yeah, but one was to a place they weren't going.
Okay.
They changed their location.
Yes.
And also, I just realized, mentioned the first athletic trip. I didn't mention the other one.
Separately.
Oh, we are doing
these are different trips.
Okay.
Sorry. At the last workshop, I mentioned that the trip to Hartford for the girls' cross country team, I had mistaken. There were 2 trips, and this trip that the girls will be taking on September 12th, was the trip that I was referring to at the last meeting. The boys and girls cross country teams will be going to traveling together. To Rhode Island. Yes. So the Hartford trip was the one I should have been referring to at the last workshop. So this is the invitational cross country meet that is for New England. It's the high elite running event. So this, the Hartford one, is different from the Rhode Island trip.
So the girls are taking 2 trips, the boys are taking 1.
Correct. Yeah. So my apologies to...
Let's keep you there as a captive audience to talk about the 2 Warwick trips.
Yes.
Those are the next 2 they've got to approve.
Okay, so is there a motion to approve the Warwick trips for both boys and girls?
So moved.
Thank you, Linda. And is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Trish. Discussion, questions?
Didn't you talk about one of the Warwick trips at our meeting in August?
Yeah, so that's at the last workshop. Okay. The Hartford, Connecticut trip was the one I was referring to. So in the packet, that's why I also included the trip that was already approved, which was to Warwick, Rhode Island. One clarification I did want to make. So the boys and girls will be traveling together to Rhode Island. The girls will be traveling by themselves to Connecticut.
Okay. Okay, so we are now looking at...
I was a little hasty in getting my information.
That's okay. So, but we're looking to approve the Warwick girls and boys.
We just did.
Well, we moved, it's moved.
Yeah, it's moved and seconded, but we haven't approved it. But that, I'm just asking for clarification.
Yes.
That's what we're doing. Okay. Because that's what I thought we were doing. Okay, other questions? No. All in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Thanks, Jeff. Okay, consideration of superintendent's nomination of new staff for 2008 and 2009.
I have one new staff nomination, and that is that Maura? Maura McDermott, who will be the instructional strategist at the high school. Am I correct? And Dominic is down there cheering, but we won't go any further with that. And so she is the new person who has been recommended for that position.
Okay. Is there a motion?
You also have her resume on the back if you have any questions.
I move that we approve the superintendent's nomination of Maura McDermott as an instructional strategist.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Trish. Discussion? Questions? All in favor? I was a little hesitant.
I just wanted to scare him.
I was going to say, is he still breathing now?
I'm losing control. It's me.
That's what you get for keeping us here till 9:30.
Well, yeah, I'm keeping you here. Okay. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendation co-curricular fee for 2008-2009.
You have several pages.
I'm moving fast now.
Yes. These are from Jeff Shedd at recommendations for high school extracurricular positions. They're all listed here with prices, et cetera. I will read them if you would like, but if you would prefer that I not, we'll take a look at them and can take a vote at that point in time.
And Alan, does this also where you're adding in?
No, I'll add those separately because those are middle school.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so, so we're doing high school and middle school separate?
Yes.
Okay.
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation for high school extracurricular.
Co-curricular
fee positions for 2008-2009.
Great. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Discussion. Okay.
Go ahead, Trish.
Go ahead, Peter.
What is an SS team member?
That is student study teams. Those are the teams. You remember earlier I mentioned the RTIs.
Between the two schools, why do we need 17?
So that what has every school has a committee. Yes, Dominic would be happy to answer that.
Okay.
Yes.
The student study teams are basically in the new law that the Department of Education has put forth that comes into effect 2010. In that law, we have to have, I think we even passed the policy on a pre-referral team, I think, actually last year. Mm-hmm. So it's already in our policy. We don't call them pre-referral team because it's kind of like, says it's special ed, but it's a student study team. So each of the teams in each of the schools are set up. They're getting ready to look at data, look at students at risk, and before they come into referral. So that's why they're in each of the buildings, because it's required by, will be required by law. Plus,
is it required by law that we have 17?
17 people on a,
yep.
I don't know about that, but I think we need the expertise around each of the around the table for a lot of these students. So I think we need more.
Tonight we're being asked to fund 17 positions. That's my question. Another country is being heard from.
Well, I think there's six per team. So that makes a really good team, but you have a lot of expertise because you have to not only do reading, math, writing, and behavior. There's four different areas that you've got to have. And if you think about all the teacher leaders that we have, you've got to have a lot of expertise around that table when you're looking at different kids.
If I can just add a word in there, that's the major part, is each of these teams. We had the SAT, PAT, TAT teams before, which had the same number of members, mm-hmm. but this is that we have representatives of each section of the school system looking at a student. I remember sitting in Tom's meeting the other day. Tom, am I correct that you had over 60 last year who were looked at by SST?
We have, on our team, we have a fifth grade representative, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, because these are the people who deal with the kids in the classroom or can go to the teachers on their teams. They know the schedules, so that when we're talking about providing services, maybe doing a little double dipping, they can pull the pieces and say, these kids are in this math at this time, and they can pick up this additional service in place of something in another area. We also have a student study team coordinator because the paperwork is quite intense. We have a person from special education, from the instructional support on that. The school nurse is on this for health concerns, as has been the school social worker. So social emotional welfare is usually another factor that we see frequently. So the people who are around, and the person who is in charge of response to intervention at our school, Melissa Sullivan. So usually the team is, it's a pretty broad-based group that we need to pull information from the different people on a nightly basis. And I would say our numbers are probably very similar to Tom's with referrals from the previous year.
And I think there's an important point, too, we need to make. Steve's is not in here yet, so next month you'll get Steve's list on this as well.
So these are, have we just renamed something?
Yes.
Okay.
Instructional support. It used to be the, for instance, it used to be the SAT, Student Assistance Team.
Yeah.
Or it previously, even before that, it was the Instructional Support Program, ISP. So it's gone through a few different things. And
we picked just, three new initials to go.
We had SATs. We had, what were the other two? TATs and CATs at the different schools. So we were just saying, you know, for parents to say it's this to this to this from the schools doesn't make a lot of sense. So let's go under one umbrella. And we decided on the SST model.
But we should also say the SST model does have different requirements because of the law. And so there are different requirements for the SSTs than there were in the TAT, PAT, TA, whatever those are, so that it does have different requirements within it as well.
Yeah, very, very data-driven, and you have to have reviews and so forth that, on students to chart whether the interventions you're using are making a difference or are not making differences and what your next steps are going to be.
So if you incorporated some of what the people before were doing, and then you've also incorporated some of the new requirements that the law is requiring.
Yeah, that's part of it. The new laws and new regulations, and then the other part of it is some of the new technologies that we have out there that are available. So, for instance, the Ames web piece, where we can have so much more access to really looking at data in a very short time span instead of waiting for an MEA and to come up in the summer or something. So we can actually use data while we've got the students working with us and make decisions to help them out inside the short ranges of time.
Okay.
And I'm assuming that the stipend relates to a certain amount of time that they're spending on these?
Yes. For instance, if you were the fifth grade representative, then you're at the weekly meeting every Wednesday afternoon after school. You are also reporting to your teams during your team meetings. And you're gathering information. You have to do a student case review when a student is brought to us. You present that case. You're letting the family know what's going on, so you're making personal contact with them, so they're hearing somebody that's from somebody who's connected to the grade level.
So is there a reason why some people are getting these stipends and some are not?
Well, some are rolled into certain job titles. For instance, let's say if in my list, I'm not sure, I think Cheryl Joy's name, for instance, might not be on my list because her position as a learning strategist would be covered so that it's part of her job title to do that as well, or excuse me, job description, so that she wouldn't also receive the stipend for that.
I would say just the last point I think we need to make is that because we haven't had a lot of time to discuss this, this is also drawing a different picture on referrals for students for special ed services. It's taking a much deeper look at students from the first step on, and therefore, in the long run, as this progresses, we'll probably change the population levels that we have in special education services.
It already is. And, of course, one of the intentions of this was to this kind of programming from the national perspective was to reduce the number of kids who will qualify for special education services. So when we formally had SAT, it was like this, and then the special education population was like this. Now we're seeing a reduction here, and these students still need some form of assistance, but they can't get it through this vehicle. So now we're seeing an expansion in the response to intervention program, and the student study teams are the vehicle that advises and supervises the response to intervention program. How's that? I didn't use initials.
You did well.
Thank you.
Just really quick, the student study teams have made a huge difference. So they cut our referrals in half from the previous year. So that's why we went down a psychologist, because we don't have to do all the testing. So we're halfway there. All the teams are working at their own levels, and there's a lot of work. But that law, if you want to read it, it's 2 pages long, and it is packed full of work. These teams are they're not going to be able to complete all the work that's required of them.
Thank you for all that information. Any other questions?
An easy one compared to that. The speech team advisor. During the budget, we got rid of debate, but not speech, correct? Thank you.
Anything else? All in favor? 6-0. Okay, Alan, consideration, I'm sorry, middle school.
So we'll go to middle school next, and that's what I passed out to you and left on your plate, on your table. It's getting late, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Prior to meeting. There are 2 pages here, they're both from Steve Conley. The first one is that Claire Ramsbach is going to replace Allison Caruso. Prior to this, you had approved Allison. And now it is going to be Claire Ramsbotham, who is going to be taking a spot on the SST. So that's the first of the 2 pages that I gave to you. And the second page you have from Steve is also his drama program. And this is a recommendation from Evan Solander and Steve Price to do drama. And I am doing it tonight because they've got to get started. They have already started. And so I needed to get this tonight so that you would know what the story is there.
Okay, is there a motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendations for a co-curricular for the middle school as presented.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Discussion, questions? All in favor? 6-0. Okay, now.
Well, I have one more. The next sheet is a recommendation for Pond Cove extracurricular positions, students, study teams, and you again have a list of those, which added up makes the 17 that Peter asked about today.
Okay. Is there a motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendations for the Pond Cove student support team extracurricular positions as presented.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Karen. Discussion?
Just a question. Do we have a higher population of instructional support needs at Pond Cove than at the high school or middle school? I mean, are we having teams at different locations, different sizes?
Yeah,
to?
It's a good point. The initiative, and I think Donald will agree, it's supposed to be bottom heavy. And I think what we're trying to do is push this down to the kindergarten level. That's why the most intensive work is done within the Pond Cove.
So we're trying to the early intervention and
right. Possibly
weed out more kids the further as they get
It's actually spread out into the classroom. What we're trying to do is by the time the kids are considered for a referral, I can vouch for the instruction they've had in the classroom and for the support they've had non-special education. So the RTI part is the last part. And it is a money saver in the long run.
Okay.
But it's supposed to be bottom heavy. It's supposed to be for the younger kids, catch them when they're young, and then we won't have to wait. I mean, the criticism, the truism about the other system was wait until they fail. We don't want to do that anymore. Right?
Right.
All right.
I mean,
just it's regular ed, and it's a lot of early intervention. There's a lot of work from tier one, which is in the classroom, to tier two, which is where a lot of literacy and math specialists are working together. You know all those people that are in those programs, all the way to when this child could be coming into special ed. So it's a long process, a lot of data, a lot of work that these people are doing. These teams are invaluable, and they've been working and changing and trying to get ready for this law. The other part, which I hate to add to their stress, but I just talked to Alan today, we still have the gifted and talented plan out there, which also does it in the reverse way. We're looking at the top 2 to 3 to 5%, and we have not selected those students. I have a plan that I'm still working with the Department of Education, so I need this same team to help me with the data, or have a data team help me, okay, who are these kids, and do we have to develop plans? Because also in these teams, they're developing personalized learning plans K through 12 for kids. So some kids are getting plans to help them. Not every kid needs a personalized learning plan, but there are some kids that do need some sort of plan to be followed. So just want to add that too.
And I just want to comment that I'm encouraged to hear that it's a bottom-heavy intervention, because when you said you were cutting your referrals in half, I guess one of my responses is that good for the kids? And it sounds like if that's why the referrals are going down, then I'm pleased to hear that.
Well, yeah, I think the referrals are going down. Well, I think because we really moved it down into kindergarten, like Tom said, and I think that a lot of the referrals that were coming in were from parents that were, you know, just wanted to make referrals. And now it is the system in place, and then they work through the process, and it really makes sense.
And just to support that, is to help.
Might as well stay.
Help kids get the help when they need it, and it's to kind of erase some of those categories before. It was painstaking. It was overladen with paperwork. This way, if a kindergartner needs help, the kindergartner can get help. And if that doesn't work, then maybe, in extraordinary circumstances, they will go to what we used to call special education. But it really shouldn't be that way. Right. So
that's the seamless services that we're working on.
Right.
So it blends. So.
And it'll save you money. It really will.
Expense-saving idea, right? Okay, thank you. Any other questions? All in favor? 6-0. Yay. Okay. Alan.
Yes.
Can we now go to the superintendent's recommendations for athletic fee positions?
You certainly may.
Please.
First page I have is from Scott Labby. He's a 3 at the middle school. None of these are new positions, but 2 of the 3 are new hires within the positions, and Scott has given a short biographical sketch on each one.
Okay. Did you want to do these by
I can do them all at once if you want me to.
Does anybody have a preference?
It's just the other one, Jeff's normal nominations, too.
Go ahead with them.
Yeah.
Okay, the other.
Do all together.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay, I have athletic fee positions. I have one that is in your booklet, which you received, and one I put on your in front of you tonight. The first one is Ryan Piper, high school varsity football assistant coach. This is one that was approved previously as a volunteer, but had been in the budget, and once the budget was passed at a certain level, the agreement was that that would become a stipended position. And so that was based on the budget as you went through it this past year. You also have on a second page from Jeff, you have Charlie Carroll, who will be the varsity boys soccer assistant. You have Andy Strout, who will be the freshman boys girls soccer. And you have Ryan also on that sheet. So it is really Charlie Carroll, Andy Strout, and Ryan.
Okay. I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendations to 4 athletic fee positions.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Well, you guys are whipping along now.
Discussion.
Questions, Trish.
Just a quick, I guess, I hope it's an easy request. We've approved these piecemeal. It's kind of hard to get your hands around how many coaches and what positions and where they are. It would be great if, I'm assuming there's a summary sheet that we could see in terms of how many positions for fall, for example, are school funded versus booster funded, and what the big picture looks like.
Sure.
And Jeff has all of those, so that we can get those.
It is a work in progress.
Which is fine. If, at the end of it, it would just be kind of nice to put it all together and get a sense of, you know, what's the booster funding? What's the school funding? How many coaches do we have in each of the different programs?
And this is actually a big topic we started to talk about last year, and just to let you know that there are stipend positions that we are covering in our budget this year that were additions to the budget that were previously booster funded. And those were part of our budget packet from Keith last year, to let you know, such as the assistant football coach. That is a position that was formerly booster funded that is now part of our budget.
But that list you're asking
right.
for, Jeff has a question. I think I have a copy of it, but we can make sure you have it.
Will it highlight those situations?
I believe it's set up in the same format as far as where the, it's the same exact format.
So
where
we'll
the funding,
have,
where it says funding school or booster.
So we'll know how many are truly new positions.
They aren't necessarily new positions. They have changed.
But that's a new
right.
position for the school budget. So
we may need to add a column asking if it's newly funded, if the funding has changed.
Yeah. That's what I'm trying to get at.
Yep.
Okay. I agree. But it is a work in progress right now.
Thanks.
Similar format, maybe just including the window section if that's a change.
Right. Yes. That would be great. Thank you.
Other questions? All in favor? 6-0. Okay, Alan, consideration of appointment of school board members as a delegate to the Maine School Boards Association. I'll do this, yeah. Okay.
It's all yours.
It's mine, okay. This is, gee, thanks. This is the thing that we have that comes up every October. And I guess the question is, and we talked about this last year in the calendar committee, and we bagged it because we made a mistake in not remembering that this is when they have parent-teacher conferences. So the question is, does anybody want to go to Augusta on whatever day that is, and I can't find it.
October 23rd and 24th.
Yep, thank you. To be our delegate.
How important is this position that you Just because my children are 30 years old doesn't mean I have to be punished.
I didn't look
we'll
at you like
a stipend
that way.
For you. For yeah.
Could this, yes, could this be a co-curricular position?
Yes.
Good try.
No. You will not be paid for this service. You might be reimbursed for
I'll pay you 20% of what I pay you now.
I think we're still waiting for the session schedule. And
we don't have it yet.
I think it would be more important if we could figure out some of us could cover some of the sessions more so than
being a delegate.
Delegate.
Yes.
Again, I'd like to look at the schedule, Trish, to see how worthy it is to spend the day.
Exactly.
It hasn't arrived yet, so we're just waiting for that now.
So do you want to table this?
Yeah.
Well, it says it needs to be returned.
I'll be willing
by
to volunteer
9th.
As long as it's substantial.
At the next meeting.
I think it's after. I think our next meeting is after.
So we should, well.
Do I write to table it?
Can we? Can you get a thing there in 2 days?
Sure.
Sure. I'm just curious, when is that sort of the annual school board conference that takes place up there that I've been to?
That's it.
This is around.
That's the one you went to.
Okay.
Went.
So we can still opt to go up there and
Do
some of that without having to be a delegate.
A delegate, yes.
Right. Okay. That was sort of what I was saying.
And we'll be receiving information on that, I would imagine.
Yeah, still waiting for it. Hasn't been.
Okay.
Okay, so
I move we table consideration of the appointment of the school board member as a delegate to the Maine School Board Association Fall Conference.
Okay. Do I need a second? Yeah. Okay, well, we'll do it anyway. All in favor? Okay. Consideration of lease purchase agreement for school bus. I can't speak. Sorry.
You have in your packet bus lease for 0809, vote to be adopted. Remember, we have discussed this before. We are trying to keep a program, but we do continue to replace buses because we have some that are quite old, and we are trying to get caught up from a period of time when we weren't buying them on a regular basis. This is a lease plan, just so you do understand that the board chose several years ago to do a lease plan as opposed to paying full price. What you will need to do, and I don't know how you want to do that, but this is the wording that has to be in our minutes to send on to the loaning institution.
I think in the past we haven't read the whole
no.
thing.
No.
And we don't need to. We can reference it. Okay.
That's why I was being very, very careful.
Careful how you said that.
Yes.
Is there a motion?
Try it. I move that we approve the lease purchase agreement as written in our package for a school bus.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion, questions?
Just have one question.
Yep.
Why doesn't this go out to bid?
Go out to bid?
Yes.
My understanding, I turn to Pauline, but my understanding is we do take a look at them from the perspective of what is offered, am I correct?
Are we talking about the bus?
Yes.
The bus going out to bid. This is a bid through the state Department of Education. It has gone out to bid through the state.
So this is the state's lowest bid, and as a municipality, we're allowed to participate, much like other purchases we do as a municipality. So it has been competitive, and it is the lowest price available. Thank you, Pauline.
Well, there are three companies, usually, I think it is, major companies.
Yes, usually they're
the. Other questions? All in favor? 6-0. Okay. Is there anybody that wants to make a committee report? Good. Really, is there anybody that wants to say anything important?
We wouldn't dare now.
No, only Rebecca was getting the look.
And I looked away.
I know you did. No. Okay. And before we get to the end, I do want to make sure that everybody here looks over the meetings, the dates to remember, so if there's some changes there, we can make those. Public comment on a. On agenda items, nope, seeing none. School board agenda requests. Nope. Announcement of upcoming meetings. Okay. Extracurricular was today at 7:30 in the Jordan Conference Room, correct? And when would be the next meeting?
We just had 8:00.
All right, now.
7?
We know when the
next
first Tuesday.
Yeah. Was the second?
October 7th.
October 7th.
7:30 a.m.
In the Jordan Conference Room.
Yep.
October 7th. Okay. Finance Committee is Wednesday, September 24th at 8.
Yes. Correct.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Personnel Thursday, September 11th at 8 a.m. Jordan Conference.
To be determined.
Oh.
The place or the
personnel. That meeting's not yet scheduled.
Yeah, we haven't scheduled.
Okay, so personnel's to be determined. Policy, Tuesday, September 16th, 12 noon, Jordan Conference. Wellness, Monday, October 6th, 3:15, Fire Station Meeting Room. I know there's something missing. Isn't there something missing? No? Am I missing anybody's committee? No. Okay. School Board Workshop is Tuesday, September 23rd at 7 p.m. in the High School Library. Do we yet have an agenda for that?
Yes, that is the one we mentioned earlier where the administrators and I will report on our summer workshop.
Okay.
The direction and the maybe in the school system.
Great. And then our next regular school board meeting will be Tuesday, October 14th at 7 p.m. in the council chambers.
Oh, that's after that date.
Oh.
We just tabled that.
We just tabled. Oh, that is on October 14th.
The delegate thing.
Yep, we did.
We meet the second and fourth, that's right. That's my fault.
Then do you want to go back and deal with the delegate piece? Consideration of appointment of school board member as delegate to the main school.
A recommendation?
Yes.
Can we have a special meeting right before our workshop on the 23rd to give us an opportunity to look at the brochure?
Wonderful idea. Yeah. Anybody have a problem with that suggestion?
No.
Oh, okay, great.
Let's get that one.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
I move we adjourn.
Thank you, Linda. Is there one second? Thank you, Trish. All in favor?
You didn't ask for the discussion.